final regular season game for Highland Park. The Scots 9-0 in closeout district play here in Richardson tonight against 4-5 J.J. Pierce. Our JSX pregame show starts right after this.
Customer service is really unparalleled. I've never seen anything like it with any other company.
The emblem, it just says a lot. It means, hey, I bought from Sewell.
They listened to what I had to say and actually cared about my experience.
Every once in a while, you want to be spoiled, and Sewell does that.
It's not just a transaction. That's the thing about Sewell.
I will always drive a Sewell.
Discover our wide variety of new and certified pre-owned vehicles at Sewell Cadillac or SewellCadillac.com.
Determination on the field breeds determination in life. Discipline needed on the court will be the same discipline that gets the job done. That's why Tailwater Capital is a proud supporter of the Highland Park Athletic Program, the winningest athletic program in the state of Texas. 11 Lone Star Cups, 112 state championships, and a commitment to excellence that serves its players for a lifetime. From the locker room to the boardroom, Scots find a way.
In the end, it's not the politician that builds this country. It's the entrepreneur carrying the world's largest economy on their shoulders, putting Americans back to work. Really, they're the only ones who ever could. We've always been the entrepreneur's bank for the century behind and the century ahead. Vista Bank. Entrepreneurs. Banking entrepreneurs. Since
19. We welcome you to Richardson tonight for Highland Park football. The Scots take on the J.J. Pierce Mustangs tonight. It's a series in which the Scots have won 10 consecutive games. Last time they lost to Pierce was back in 2001. So Scots have a pretty good track record against the Mustangs. Along with Jim Castellaw and Jay Ellis, I'm Russell Scott, and we welcome you into the press box. We had weather last week. We've got weather again tonight, don't we?
It's all blown through, though. I think the worst of it has come and gone. There were some massive lightning strikes here about 5 o'clock, but whoever made the decision, Coach Allen or Coach Webb, to move this to 8 o'clock, wise move.
But it is a little bit colder and probably cooler than it's been for any of our games so far.
You know, it's not cold up here in your press box, but down there in my field, it's awfully cold.
Depends on where your workspace is.
Yeah, there's some wind out there, too, but you know, it's a good experience for these kids.
Let's talk a little bit about the Scots last week. They turned in another shutout. They beat Richardson 31-0. Another good way to get prepared for the playoffs.
Well, and I think the coaches, Coach Allen and the defensive coaches, were very happy with the way the defense showed progress last week. They were tackling much better. They were flying to the ball. They were getting off the field, doing all the things that you need. They've been harping at them to do. Interestingly enough, though, talking to Coach Leitner, he said, we definitely, as coaches, ratcheted up the intensity in practice, and so I think you saw the result of that in the game last Friday night.
Well, it's a final game before you go to the playoffs next week. We'll be at Highlander Stadium next Friday night for round one of the playoffs, but what do you want to do in a game like this? You're expected to win the game, but you don't want to get anybody hurt, so how do the Scots play this one tonight?
Well, you said part of it right there. You don't want to get anybody hurt. You know, next week it really counts, but you want to be crisp. You want to execute. You want to be disciplined. You want to make sure that that your guys are doing everything they're supposed to. And these coaches are working hard all week to make sure that that they're disciplined. And I think if they come out crisp, get a few touchdowns early, make some stops, then it'll give them an opportunity to let some of those guys sit safely on the bench in the second half.
You're sitting there watching the guys warm up right now prior to tonight's game. There you've got a really good look at Highland Park's offense.
And notice all the coaches with coats on. When I came in the stadium earlier this afternoon, it was 80 degrees, I think, out. The cold front has definitely come through.
Give me your thoughts on J.J. Pierce and what they will present tonight for Highland Park.
Well, J.J. Pierce is in a unique position. They've still got a shot at the playoffs. Now, they have to pull the upset tonight, defeat Highland Park, and then Berkner has to lose to MacArthur. So a long shot, but they've got something to hold on to, even if it's their fingernails. And so they're going to give Highland Park their best shot. I think the thing you're going to see out of from watching film on J.J. Pierce, they run more trick plays than anybody I've ever seen. They run belly bomb. They run a toss sweep out of wing tee. They run a lot of formations and a lot of trick plays. So I think Coach Jersey, he's going to empty the playbook tonight as far as things that could give the Scots problem. I know Highland Park has been working on that all week, but you can only work on what you've seen.
Exactly. Jared Lambert is the head coach for the Pierce Mustangs. He got the job very late in the year. Head coach Collins left in June. He came in and had to make a lot of changes and had to really scramble to get things ready for this season. I had a chance to catch up with him. Let's listen to Coach Lambert's comments.
Pretty quick over the summer, and when Coach Collins announced that he was leaving, and then I was able to step in this role, and it was a little process, waiting process, and it made things interesting, and we had several coaches that we had to hire still, so it was it would talk about fast and furious, and felt like I was drinking water from a fire hose. And we got a pretty young team, and we kind of stumped our toe in early on in non-district games, and put ourselves in a hole a little bit, and it was some good lessons for our kids to learn. And we dropped the first four games and then turned around and went on a three-game win streak, and then lost to Lake Highlands, and then won again last week against Irving. And so we knew coming in this season we were going to have a young team and have to overcome some things, and just seeing the kids grow each week, it's been fun to watch that process and them just continue to improve each week.
And coming off that win over Irving last week, you had to feel pretty good about how you played last week. Just talk a little bit about your offense and how they've been playing.
Our offense. Well, let's talk about just last week first. I mean, it made for an interesting game. And as soon as we get on the field to start pregame warm up, we go into our first delay, and We kind of sat around and kept resetting. And, we finally got the okay to take the field at 7, and we decided we're going to kick off at 7:30. And so we got the kids warmed up real quick and got going. And, we talked to our kids, and to be ready for, those type of elements and stuff. And we can't worry about how many delays that, get presented to us. All we can do is just go out and respond and control what we can control. And I felt like our guys responded really well last week and able to go do that. And we got started at 7:30, and things took off quick for us. It worked out well. We were up 21-0. There were still 7 minutes, 11 seconds left in the first quarter, and we went into another delay, which was ended up being the last delay of the night for us. And, our guys just, they really responded well. And, in that situation, and just worrying about things that we can control. And, they came out and played a complete ball game. So it sets us up nice going into the final district game, and, knowing that, in order for us to, have some success, we're going to have to come out and, we're going to have to execute and execute at a high level. So that's what we're looking forward to, and seeing if, all the lessons that we've learned this year, we can come in and play a quality opponent like Highland Park and get us a win. So our offense has been, playing really well. What was pretty pretty fun to watch in last week's game, it was an opportunity to spread the ball around a little bit, and just about every skilled player on the team had an opportunity either run the ball or catch the ball. Of course, it was with it being wet, not everybody caught the football, but everybody was given a chance to have that opportunity, and it was fun. We got up early, which presented that self to us and gotten everybody in the game. So it was a fun night for us.
That is head coach Jarrett Lambert, the head coach of the Pierce Mustangs. Is his team not out of the playoff picture just yet, but they would have to have the upset win tonight. And Highland Park comes into the game with a 9-0 record. We've got the Scots and the Mustangs, and our JSX pregame show rolls on right after we take this quick timeout.
With almost 100 offices across the state of Texas, and 50 of them in the DFW area alone, Capital Title is here to serve you. Made by Texans, for Texans. Capital Title is the largest independent title company in the United States. We are Dallas-born, Dallas-based, and family-owned. We support the Highland Park Scots.
It's the Baker Brothers replay. The best offense is a good defense. Baker Brothers blocked those surges before they could take it to the house.
That play was electric.
That's right, Jimmy.
Shocking, even.
We get it, Jimmy.
Call now to get this month's electric special.
Back in Richardson as we get you set for the Highland Park Scots and the J.J. Pierce Mustangs. Joining me in the booth now, our student assistant, Owen Marie. How are you?
I'm doing great today. I'm ready for my final regular season game of my entire high school career. It's a little bit emotional for me, but, you know, more or less, I'm just excited to see my guys get out there and play the best they can.
Okay, playoffs start next week. What are your thoughts on the playoffs and who has to step up or what has to happen for Highland Park to be successful?
I mean, at the end of the day, we all have to step up. Everyone has to be on their A game consistently. Even our depth guys have to be at the top of their games. And I'm looking for someone like Barrett Denton to make a real standout play. You know, that guy is someone who I see going to school, working day in and day out, make sure his grades are peak, top of the class. And the effort that he gives out on the field is just unparalleled to what I've seen, especially for a guy that doesn't get as many reps as the starters, but it's absolutely wonderful to see what he does on the field.
Over on the offense, who do you like?
On the offense, you know, I like a guy like Frank Musa. You know, he's earned his reps throughout the entire year, and it's really impressive to see a guy who just works, and just see him just shine when given the opportunities that he's given, and I'm really proud of him. And he actually committed to go play D1 lacrosse last week, which is pretty impressive.
Okay, well, the other thing you do is basketball, and what are we expecting from the Scots this year on basketball?
Oh, I'm real excited. We got this one kid, Dylan Walker, absolutely amazing scorer. I mean, we all know about Mr. Jackson Heiss. You know, he's wide receiver here, but small forward in basketball, absolute animal in the paint. And same goes for Mr. Colson Messer. He's an absolute animal in the paint. The guy is absolutely massive. I guarantee you could probably bench 300 pounds, but, you know, I'm just excited to see what we can do next year.
Willing to go out and give us a prediction for basketball? You don't have to do that. I'll put you on the spot.
You're putting me on the spot here. I couldn't give you a prediction right now, but I can guarantee you Dylan Walker will average something like 15 points a game.
All right.
Solid prediction.
And you will be there for all the games, so
absolutely.
We're going to tune in. We'll
absolutely
be able to listen to you and
mm-hmm.
watch you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Owen Marie, our student assistant, doing a great job for us all season long. Thank you so much for joining us here in the press box.
No problem.
We've got some video that we want to roll from Coach Burt. He is one of the defensive coaches, and Jim had a chance to catch up and let him talk a little bit about his defensive line, and he says they really have been giving maximum effort as of late.
You know, I hold everybody to a high standard, from the guy at the top of the totem pole to the bottom of the totem pole, and sometimes, you know, what I tell the leaders of the defensive line group is if you want to be leaders, you're gonna pay for those that are the weaker links on the chain. So or for anybody dragging, anybody that's dragging, the top of the totem pole is going to pay too. So, you know, they do a good job of holding each other accountable.
Right. And so you got the leaders really being leaders and making sure that everybody's doing their job.
That is Coach Burt. The other thing he talked to Jim about was having six different guys who rotate in among three different positions, and he considers all six of those to be starters.
Exactly. It's exactly how I look at it. Matter of fact, my top six, who I consider true starters, they rotate every week as to who gets to go out in that first defensive series each game.
Right.
So I think this week it might be Richter, Ellis, and Carroll, I think. Mm-hmm. I think this week. I don't know.
Right, but it changes.
Yeah, it changes.
They all start.
And again, our thanks to Coach Burt for joining us on the pregame to talk a little bit about his defense. And thanks to Owen Marie. They tell me you're going to be helping out the Mavericks.
Yes, I actually am a ball boy this season. It's been very exciting. You know, it's been a little bit of tough, but, you know, I'm getting used to it and I'm having a lot of fun.
So if I come out to the Mavs game, I can see and cheer not only for the players, but for you as well?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What about tickets?
Tickets? No. I can hook y'all up with something. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. They might be nosebleeds. They don't give me much leeway. But,
Cuban started out in the nosebleeds. So there you go.
Yeah. We're going to be asking him for tickets, I think, for a long time, I've got a feeling. We need to get to a break.
Well, I just want to say thank y'all for giving me this opportunity, and thank y'all all in the truck. And I would just like to say I'm never going to forget this, and I'm really happy I did this.
Hey, just when you make it big, and you will, in my estimation, remember the little guys.
Okay? I definitely will, Mr. Castle. This is the JSX pregame show. We'll be back in just a minute.
We live in a country that's been forged from all walks of life. The values of the American cowboy and the code of the West have stood the test of time. They're ingrained into who we are and who we strive to be. Cavenders, this is how we live.
Our name, Residential Capital Partners, reflects who we are and how we treat our customers. At Residential Capital Partners, we are dedicated to helping our customers build wealth through real estate. Residential Capital Partners, America's private lender.
Conveniently located between Lovers Lane and University Boulevard on Preston Road, Not Just Soccer is locally owned and has served the Highland Park community for youth sports equipment needs since 1989. Whether you're looking for soccer, football, basketball, baseball, volleyball, or lacrosse equipment, they carry it all, and they take pride with specialists in each sport, and in many circumstances, you'll be helped by a current Highland Park athlete. Go Scots!
The service after the sale is something that will keep bringing my wife and I back as Sewell customers. Give them about 48 hours, tell them what you need service for. They bring you a loan car, pick up your car, take it back, do the service, and come and pick up the loan car. That's like being royalty. If that doesn't invoke loyalty, I don't know what does. I drive a Sewell.
Discover our wide variety of new and certified pre-owned vehicles at Sewell Cadillac or SewellCadillac.com.
Our JSX pregame show rolls on as we get you ready for Highland Park and J.J. Pierce. And there are a couple of guys who are going to be watching very closely tonight. Tim Storr and... Nope, got the wrong one.
That's Tim Storr on the left.
On the left. And
I haven't met the guy he's speaking with, but he's wearing Highland Park blue and gold.
No.
So...
We're being told so he may be one of the trainers for the team.
We need Owen back over here because he knows everybody.
That's right. That's right. Even with their back turned.
Okay, well, the Scots came out with another 31-0 shutout last week, their third shutout of the season. How much confidence, how much do you get out of a 31-0 shutout?
Well, I think the defense gets a tremendous amount. I mean, that, I don't care who they're playing. I don't care what the score is. You know, they can be up 50-0. They want that shutout if they can get it, and we've seen it for a couple weeks in a row now. But I think that's hugely important to giving you confidence. Because this game, when you look at it, this is the springboard of the playoffs. This is the dress rehearsal, if you will. And, you know, last week was a prep for this. So I think you're going to want to be in that position to get another one if you can do it.
And Russell, you know, what won't show up in the score box or what we won't look back and see in the newspaper, but at the very end of the game, Highland Park had some backups in the game that made a goal line stand. And, and the play that stands out in my mind was the very last play of the game where the two inside linebackers, Sam Webster, crossed on sort of a stunt, and Ben Salter came up and met the running back in the hole and made just a form tackle. And that matters, and I'll tell you why. Those guys will have their opportunities when it counts. Just this week, a lot of kids had stomach bugs.
Oh, yeah.
There were very few linebackers practicing early in the week. I don't know how that's turned out by tonight, but we're going to need guys like Sam Webster and Ben Salter and a lot of those other guys that were making great plays last Friday.
And did you see the sideline when those backups made the play? The starters were going wild on
the
sideline.
Let's go ahead and roll some of the highlights from last week's game.
We may see that, but the biggest fans of the second team were the starters on the sideline jumping up and down.
Again, the final score, 31-0.
This week's highlights are brought to you by Beacon Point Advisory, aligning your wealth with what matters most. Go Scots!
Dox in the backfield. Here's Axley.
Oh, yeah.
Dox, and he'll take it right into the end.
Dragging over the middle.
Here's Jake.
Oh!
Handoff. Touchdown. A 6-yard touchdown run for Jake Dox.
The back keeper is going to help.
Nope. They're going to give it to Frank Musin. He's got the touchdown. Here's Kane.
Oh,
he's got lots of time.
Throw. Oh, here we go.
Off. Highland Park's got it.
That's Ballard.
From the 36-yard line comes Max Ballard.
Max Ballard. Here we go.
Ballard up
here
the right sideline, outside the numbers, and into the end zone. Armstrong here.
Oh.
The blitz, and they got to Armstrong and sacked it.
Four right there, that last picture holding up the trophy.
Absolutely, the district championship trophy right there. And Jim, you had a chance to catch up with a couple of the players this week to get our, you're looking at senior night here for J.J. Pierce. That's the seniors who are out on the field right now. But I know you talked to Ethan Burt, and he talked a little bit about what to expect from Pierce's offense and kind of what Coach Leitner has told the defense are the keys to victory.
Well, they're pretty much 50-50 until about the end zone where they'll go a little more 60-40 pass. We know they like to run a lot of trick plays and they have a bunch of funky formations. So it'll be a fun game.
Is it when you play a team that goes wild on formations, does it make you get kind of vanilla in that, and we're not going to try to adjust to every single thing, or do you adjust to every one?
Oh, yes, sir. We try to stay vanilla, but if there's something that we just can't fix, then we'll probably adjust to it.
And what is your thoughts on their quarterback and his ability to push the ball upfield to his receivers?
He looks like a pretty good quarterback. Definitely, if we don't have our eyes right, he'll definitely do something dangerous to us.
Yeah. And what about their running attack? Is it something to worry about?
Yes, sir, it is. They have a pretty good running back. I don't really know his height and weight, but he's one of those people, if we also don't fill our gaps and all that, he'll get a bunch of yards.
He'll crease you. Well, you guys, I think back to the MacArthur game, and you went against two guys for MacArthur, number 22 and number 1, that I think were as good as anybody you've seen, and you guys bottled them up very well against MacArthur. Is there a key to doing that, or is it just each guy does his job and in the end it all works out right?
Well, it's a little bit of both. We Coach Leitner and all the coaches come in together one day and they throw a whole bunch of coverages and pretty much come up with a game plan. So they got a good one good scheme going on for this game as well.
Right. And Ethan, same question for you. Has anything Coach Leidner or your dad, for that matter, said, hey, these are the two things or whatever you have to do if we're going to win this game on the defense?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Like Ogle said, they got everything to lose right now. So, or nothing to lose, but they're coming from a playoff spot. So we also have once a week after a game, we have correction sheets. And one thing, every position emphasized was physicality. So we need to come out very physical this game.
Senior cornerback Ethan Burt right there. He was talking about the quarterback, Presley Harper, who is only a sophomore.
Right.
So you got to watch him. He's only thrown, he's thrown for 1,000 yards. I don't want to say only thrown for 1,000
right.
yards.
Only. And then keep in mind, Ethan Burt is Coach Burt's son.
Absolutely. And you grow up, I would think, in that environment. By osmosis, being close to your dad. And
I asked him, I said, you know, they ride an hour back and forth to school every day together. Do you talk to your dad? Does he coach you in the car? And he goes, well, not so much in the car because I'm a lot. He goes, when we get home and we have the chance, yes, he's because he used to be, Coach Burt used to be a defensive backfield coach at Duncanville. So he knows a lot about Ethan.
Pierce offense averages 221 yards a game, only 88 on the ground, 133 through the air, and they average about 15 points a game. But what about their defense? Jim caught up with sophomore Will Ogle to talk about him, to talk a little bit about the Mustangs defense and what Coach Allen is thinking the keys to a victory are going to be.
Yes, sir. So they run an even front, which, you know, we've played before, so we shouldn't have too much trouble with that. But they also run a really interesting sort of front where they shift three D linemen to the left of the center and will have one free standing end. And they'll run that on the other side also. And we've never seen something like that before. So a lot of practice has been focused on that one formation because we've been running a four-man front. I think we have that under control, but I think if we can figure out all their weird things they run, we'll do just great. And, you know, if they win this game, they'll be able to win the playoffs. So we're definitely going to be getting the best of Pierce. So we're going to have to put on our A game.
All right. And you guys don't remember this. You're too young. But, God, 10 years ago, 12 years ago, Pierce was a big Highland Park rival, and they had much better teams. And so they were close games. And I'm sure they are remembering that. Are you prepared for the rain though, if it comes, knowing that means you're going to have to run the ball?
Yes, sir. You know, obviously Jay Cox is injured, so that's going to take a very. We're going to have to play around that, but I have full faith in our running backs. You know, Wilson Haxley, Frank Musa, they'll do just fine. We're obviously going to have to run the ball a lot more, but I think we're more than capable of doing that.
Right. And has Coach Allen stressed one or two things offensively that you guys got to do to be successful and win the game?
You know, we really just got to, as an offensive lineman, we just got to get our blocks. You know, in this game, there's not going to be a lot of room. Sometimes with not as good teams, you can miss and you'll be fine. But JJ Pierce, they're going to play their all. And we're really going to have to step up.
Sophomore Will Ogle right there, and both of those guys well-spoken and sound like they're ready to go tonight.
Exactly, yeah. And Will Ogle, as a sophomore, he's really done well already this year. He's jumped in and played a lot of guard, and he's going to get leaned on a lot tonight.
One of the things that we haven't really touched on are injuries, and not so much an injury but a precautionary situation, Jay Cox.
Yeah, so my understanding is Jay Cox won't be playing tonight, but that's, you know, it's good and bad. It's good because it means more reps for Wilson Haxley and for Frank Musa, maybe some of the others. And those are guys that have been really strong the last several weeks and who we're going to need in the playoffs. So I think it's a great opportunity for those two guys.
Right. And talking about Ogle, same precautionary measure. Lawson Petty is sitting out tonight. Precautionary measure, could play if he had to, but they're trying to rest him, get him 100% ready for the playoffs. So that means Watts, Pickleman, and Ogle will rotate between the left guard and left tackle positions.
Kind of get that rotation going like the defense has.
Exactly.
With many of theirs.
It works over there.
Health-wise, everybody going to be there ready to go on the defensive side of the ball?
Yes. And talking
might limit Rourke. Just same precautionary deal. Rourke will probably start tonight, but if the Scots can get a lead, you can look for probably Rourke to come out. Again, that's where Mac Ballard got his shot last week, got the pick six for a touchdown.
It's going to be a great game. It's 14-4. That's how many times they've played. 18 times. Highland Park's won 14 of those, 10 in a row. And Scott Farrell was texting me some stuff. Said the longest game ever played by Highland Park was a triple overtime. Do you remember that one?
I was there.
I was there, too.
The only thing I remember is standing by a fence. I think it was a day game, maybe, was it?
No, it was a night. It was a night. And I remember Carolyn Allen, Coach Allen's wife, tells this story. She met somebody years later, and he said, "Oh, so your husband is Coach Allen Highland Park?" Wait a minute. He pulled out his wallet, and he pulled out a picture, all wrinkled, of the scoreboard showing Pierce had won that game, and he'd carried it all these years. And she said, they're hanging on to that.
It's been a long time since Mustangs won a game in this series. Highland Park's won 10 consecutive over J.J. Pierce. They try to make it 11 consecutive tonight and also try to hold on to a perfect season. The Scots come into the game tonight 9-0, and they already have won the district. They've got their eyes set on the playoffs next week. Stay with us. Our pregame show has been brought to you by JSX, and we will be ready for kickoff here in just a moment.
Out of service culture. And I don't think there's anybody in our company that believes otherwise. Everybody understands that our mission is to take care of families.
And I think what makes me the most proud is how many families and lives we have actually touched. We've been so impactful for so many people and in different ways of their lives, in ways we couldn't necessarily anticipate.
Attention Highland Park Scots and SMU fans, football is back at Highlander and on the Hilltop. And so is your favorite neighborhood burger joint, Goff's Hamburgers. It's the same burgers, same fries, hot dogs, and chicken you loved as a kid, but now in a brand new location. Goff's is now on Mockingbird between SMU and Central Expressway. Drop in for that unmistakable charcoal grill taste. Host a private party in the back room, or hang out and enjoy the Highland Park and SMU memories hanging on the walls. Goff's Hamburgers, proud supporter of the Highland Park Scots.
We see you, early riser, paying the price, making your move. We see you because we are you. Entrepreneurs banking entrepreneurs. As one of the few Texas banks participating in the Main Street Lending Program, Vista Bank is helping small businesses put America back to work. Isn't it time you join the over 1,500 new PPP clients and make your move to a bank that hustles as hard as you do? Vista Bank. People first.
Curtis Law, the game-winning lawyer.
I'm a link in the chain. I am a link in the chain. I am a link in the chain.
I'm 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 a link in the chain.
I am a link in the chain.
I am a link in the chain.
I'm 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 a link in the chain.
When you play one of us, you play all of us.
Well, since Highland Park hired Randy Allen to be their head coach, he has averaged better than 10 wins a season. Tonight, the Scots come into the game against J.J. Pierce, 9-0. They try to make it a perfect 10-0 if they can knock off J.J. Pierce tonight. We come to you from Richardson, and we are just minutes away from kickoff. Stand by. Highland Park football is coming up next.
Presented by Inwood National Bank.
The National Weather Service has issued a severe thunderstorm warning.
Can you feel that? Yeah. It's time to bring the fire. Make the ground shake when we come. Come on.
Touchdown, Jaycocks. Come on. He's got it. Touchdown, Harlan Parks.
Let's go. Let's go. Yeah, we go rain and we go shine when it's go time.
It'll be the 19th time that Highland Park and J.J. Pierce have met, and at one time this was a pretty heated rivalry, but the Scots have won 10 consecutive in this series, and tonight they try to make it 11 straight wins over the Mustangs. We welcome you in to Richardson, where the Scots will finish up the regular season. They put their 9-0 record on the line tonight against the Mustangs, who come into the game with a 5-4 mark, and a team that still has a playoff shot if they can upset Highland Park. They've also got to get some help from some others as well. You get a good look at the players as they have just come out of the locker room, and we're just minutes away from kicking off tonight's game. Along with Jim Castillo, I'm Russell Scott. Let's talk a little bit about the weather, because that's what everybody is talking about. We weren't even sure we were going to get the game in at one point, but they move it back an hour, and Highland Park's ready to go, and it looks like the weather has cleared up for us.
It has, and we've got football weather back again. It's nippy a little bit outside. Everybody on the sidelines and coats and jackets, not because of rain, but just because that cold front did blow through, and it was a big one. We were lightning cracks all over the place here earlier this afternoon, but we got a great night for football right now, and we're one of the few games in town. Almost everybody else, in my estimation, tried to play last night if they could. Scots couldn't quite and get that done due to scheduling conflicts here at Eagle Mustang Stadium, and so we're here tonight. Ended up having a great night.
Well, you see the stats on your screen right there. 54 degrees, the southeast wind at 19 miles an hour, so it's going to be brisk. And our weather report tonight is brought to you by Peggy Sue's Market. Fine Texas barbecue since 1951, and it's now available inside New York Subs. Well, the players getting ready for this one. They're coming off a shutout last week, and one of the interesting things, we talked a little bit about the defense and how good it feels to hang a zero on your opponent. But the other thing is they didn't allow a play over 20 yards in last week's game.
Right, and you cut out those big plays, and you cut out a lot of the momentum builders that the teams feed on. And Scots, again, they're getting more refined, better and better at what they're doing, especially on the defensive side of the ball, you know, as we move on late in the season. Offense has been potent and powerful all year long, but I know, again, Coach Allen would like, he's very confident in his ability to throw the ball. Brennan Storr has just been magnificent all season long, putting the ball where it needs to be, but I know that he would like to get a little better running the ball. He's going to be missing one key offensive lineman and captain, Lawson Petty, but it gives you a chance to see what your backups can do and what your backup running backs can do with Jay Cox out of the game as well.
Here's some overall stats for Highland Park offensively. 3,481 yards through nine games. That averages out to 387 yards. They're rushing for 139 per game, passing for almost 248 per game. But maybe the best stat, the most impressive stat, they've only turned the ball over three times. One of those came last week on a fumble. They also have thrown two interceptions, but only three turnovers in nine games. That's something something to hang your hat on.
That it definitely is, and that may be one of the best stats as far as turnovers that I've seen for Highland Park in all the years we've been doing it. That's going to be key when the playoffs get here. The other thing they've been, I think, doing a great job of is limiting the penalties. You know, we see other teams literally kill themselves with penalties. Highland Park has not done that, and they've done a pretty good job of limiting those all year long and giving themselves a chance to make big plays.
Yeah, only 42 penalties all season long. Let's look back. Last week, 4 penalties, 3 the week before, 5 the week before, 4 they never had double-digit penalties in any game this season.
And very few of those penalties have been drive killers, and that's what you really look for. Teams we've been playing, we've seen it time after time again. If it's not a bad snap or a fumble, it's a silly penalty that puts them out of the ability to make the first down. You hear the official saying Highland Park defers the choice till the second half, which probably means that Pierce is getting the ball.
Get a look at it right here, and Pierce will defend the south goal, and they will get the football first. So the Scots will play defense to start things off. And some overall numbers for the Scots defensively: they're only allowing 13 points a game, 290 yards a game they're giving up on average, 143 on the ground, 147 through the air, and again, 3 shutouts this season. So we're just minutes away from getting this one underway. Unusual for Highland Park not to take the ball first.
It is. Usually Coach Allen wants to take it and wants to do it, but, see what he can do with his offense. But again, I'm looking at the wind. The wind has been blowing. I'm wondering if the wind had something to do with that. But, yeah, that is one of the few times that Coach Allen has his guys defer.
I believe Jay Ellis is along the sideline for us tonight. I think he has made his way down there. Jay, are you somewhere you can talk to us?
Absolutely.
What's the wind like? What's the feel like down there?
You're still in the press box, aren't you?
You know, I told some people usually when I say down here on the field, it means I'm actually in the press box, but I am on the field. Those in the stadium can see me. I'm on the 20-yard line away from the scoreboard where the team just ran out. There is a strong wind, and it's pretty chilly. I think it will have some effect on throwing the ball and on the kicking game as well, but that's a challenge that our guys are up to. I will tell you there was some excitement pregame over here. Our Owen Murray, of course, our intern spotted Jack Curtis, who was, of course, the district MVP last year. Jack's over on the side. It looks like with a guy who's probably one of his teammates at Air Force Academy.
Air Force let him come home. They gave him a weekend pass.
That's right. And I'll tell you, if you're looking for him in the stands, he looks different. There's that long hair is no longer there, but he's still a big, bad dude.
How surprising. they wouldn't let him keep his long hair.
Right, okay. Right.
Feel like we may hear from him before this game is over tonight.
I bet we could make that happen.
We always like to hear about the first year in the military. We've heard that from several guys.
Jack Sides.
Yeah.
And
Winston Gamzo.
That's right.
Who is still over, if I'm not mistaken, in Poland, maybe, with the Green Berets.
We've got the presentation of the colors being made by the J.J. Pierce ROTC group, and we will have the playing of the national anthem. And as soon as that is complete, we will have kickoff of tonight's game, J.J. Pierce and Highland Park.
And at left guard, Cadet Staff Sergeant Danny Martinez. The Mustang Battalion is sponsored by retiree Lieutenant Colonel Norman Morton and Sergeant First Class Billy Patterson, Jr. Please take your own time to reflect on the freedom you enjoy as we listen to the national anthem by the Mighty Mustang Band.
playing of the national anthem. You get a look at the starting quarterback right there for the Highland Park Scots, Brennan Storr. There's head coach Randy Allen, who comes into this ball game with 279 victories at Highland Park over his career, 433 victories for head coach Randy Allen. Now, he's been under the weather as well. I usually talk to him on Thursday mornings, and he texted me about 6 o'clock and said he was going to head home and go into the doctor. Hopefully, he's going to make it through the game tonight.
Yeah, I hope so, too. You know, he wasn't feeling good. I know that. And Jay alluded to it earlier in the pregame show. There were a bunch of kids out with something, be it respiratory, flu, or something else. But at one point, all of the starting linebackers were out this week. Thankfully, not all at the same time. And several of the offensive linemen as well. So, yeah, it's that time of year where you got to, you're not only fighting the opponent, but you're fighting to stay healthy injury-wise and just general health-wise.
Scots will be kicking from left to right as we watch here from the press box. Nicholas Regis will do the kicking chores for Highland Park, and twin safeties are going to be deep for the Mustangs. They'll stand back at about their 5-yard line. And again, Highland Park will have the wind here in the first quarter of play.
Let's see. You generally, with the wind, Regis can pound it pretty deep in the end zone if the coaches give him the green light. Let's see if that's the case right here.
Regis steps into it, and our football game is underway. This one's going to go into the end zone. Fair catch there. They'll bring it out to the 25-yard line. So the Scots will play defense first tonight in Highland Park with their defensive starters look like this. Up on that defensive line, you've got Spencer Brown and Lewis Montgomery and Kyle Carlson. Henry Richter and Judge Ellis rotate in quite a bit. And then at linebackers for the Scots, you've got a couple of great inside linebackers in Robert Ramey and Tommy Rossley. And outside, you've got Charlie Barton and William White. And then you've got Adam Rourke and Wes Giese on the corners, and Brady Dotrieve and Carl Williams at safety tonight. Here they come, and they're going to get in there and get after Presley Harper. And a sack on the first play from scrimmage will drop him back to the 19-yard line. That's going to be a loss of 6 on the play.
And we talked about the Pierce wanting to do trick plays and razzle-dazzle. They start off right off the first play out of the box, running a fake reverse. Quarterback's trying to go downfield after he fakes the reverse, and Richter and company up front, Judge Ellis and Cormac Carroll, converge on him.
Second down and long. They'll send a man in motion. The quarterback is going to roll off to his right side. Wants to throw on the run. He'll heave this one downfield. It's going to be almost intercepted. Oh, knocked out by Wes Giese. Great defensive play there by Highland Park's cornerback. And a third down and long situation.
And Giese actually caught that ball, Russell. You probably saw that on the replay, just out of bounds over there. Watch this replay as it's coming up. Hard sprint out by the quarterback. Judge Ellis in hot pursuit. You better unload it. And right there, Giese comes up with a pick, though not able to keep his feet in bounds.
Our replays this quarter brought to you by Harris Orthodontics. They know how to tackle crooked teeth. Here we go on third and long. Quarterback's in trouble trying to set up that screen pass. He completes it, and it's going to go absolutely nowhere. They may pick up 1 yard. Henry Richter smelled it out and drops the receiver for the 1 yard gain. That was Jack McGarry on the catch from Presley Harper.
The quarterback is under heavy pressure, but the Scots defense really, they sniff out that look where they get released too quickly and they flow over to the left, able to snuff out that screen before it's got a chance to get going.
Punting situation, Julian Pham Davis is going to be deep for Highland Park. He'll stand at his own 45-yard line. And Noah Self to kick it away. He'll stand at his own 6 to receive the snap from center.
Snap.
It's high. He pulls it down, gets the kick off. And it's a knuckler, and there's going to be a flag thrown on this as Pham Davis got knocked down by one of the Mustangs before he had a chance to catch the ball. So Highland Park will get the ball right around the 45, and then they're going to tack on another 15 yards on the penalty.
So Scots are going to get field position deep into Pierce territory for their first drive. And again, that's one of those penalties we talked about.
Bears, second team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down, Highland Park.
That's one of those penalties that really kill a team if you commit them over and over again, and Pierce has done that a little bit more than they would like this year. You heard the wind whistling when the official was talking. It is really whipping down there on the field.
Highland Park's defense holds up as they have done all season long. They have not allowed an opponent to score on their opening drive in any game this season. First down, Scotts will start at the Mustangs' 30-yard line. Turn, hand it off.
This is going to be
a run over the right side. Wilson Axley is going to spin his way for a first down all the way down near the 18-yard line. Ethan Hunt finally comes through to make the tackle, but a 12-yard run for Highland Park and a first down.
A good little zone dive, kick-out block by Sweeney. Basso seals inside, and Axley, with his explosive speed, does the rest, picks up a first down.
Wilson Axley comes into the game, 28 carries, 219 yards, and three touchdowns. The most impressive part of that, he's averaging almost 8 yards per carry. First down from the 18-yard line. Ball spotted center of the field for the Scots. Brennan Storr, straight drop, looks across the middle, has all kind of time, and then cannot connect across the middle. Intended that time for Herring.
Yep, Luke Herring.
Who was coming from the wide out spot on the left side, just couldn't make the catch right there. It was too tall, and maybe a little bit of miscommunication between the two guys.
Yeah, it was a little bit of a dig route, but a slow in developing. Brennan Storr had to wait a little bit. I'm with you, Russell. I'm not sure they were on the same page there.
Andrew Maroulis out over the football. He leads that offensive line. The snap comes back to Storr. We've got a whistle as the play was developing, and this is going to be a penalty against Highland Park.
False start. Offense, number 58, illegal snap. 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
Let's give you that starting offensive line for Highland Park. You've got Andrew Maroulis in there at center. You've got Whit Basso in at right guard. Robert Sweeney in at right tackle. And at left guard, left tackle is Case Pickleman. And Jake Watts is in at left guard for Highland Park. Scott's going to send three receivers off to the left. One goes alone to the right side. That's going to be Axley in the backfield along with Storr. Here comes the option play, and Storr is going to keep it himself. He'll split two defenders. He won't get a whole lot, but he is going to get back to the original line of scrimmage, so that's going to be a 5-yard pickup. Christian Baker, inside backer on the tackle.
Good job by Brennan Storr reading the outside linebacker going to pitch back, so he turns it up on the option play to the right there. Pierce lined up in a 5-man defensive front, and the option is what will take care of that very quickly, or anything dumped right over the middle. Only one linebacker right now.
We're in the Shelby American red zone. Highland Park is, and Storr to throw. Got hit, but he released the ball in time. It's caught. Was he inbounds or out of bounds? Nope. It's Jackson Heisen. He's out of bounds. Made a great catch, just couldn't stay in bounds.
A tremendous catch by Jackson Heisen. I want to see that again. It was right under us in the press box, but let's see what we got right here. What a catch. One-handed. He's in. I think that's a catch, but Heisen doesn't get the call. Maybe he was bobbling it, but that's a tremendous effort.
He may have juggled it and not completed the catch, but he did make a great one-handed catch.
Yeah, that's a la Lilly from 2 weeks ago.
Jake Tansey's coming on. A 35-yard kick field goal attempt right here for the Scots. He had a 30-yarder last week. He's got he missed it.
Yep.
Missed it off to the left side.
Hooked it just a little bit, just slightly outside the upright as it's tailing off to the left. But he had plenty of distance. Scots are going to need those 3 points when they get in the playoffs, so it's probably a good idea to get some work at it while you can.
Well, each team's had the football one time, and nobody comes up with points. We'll see the second series now for the Mustangs.
Well, Scots up front defensively, Spencer Brown, Lewis Montgomery, Carlson in for this series.
Watch that left guard, number 75. He's 6'6", 315 pounds for the Mustangs. Yep. Handoff comes off the left side, and this is going to be Christian Baker. Baker 7 yards before he's run out of bounds by Baron Denton. And we may have a flag coming in at the end of that play as well.
Yeah, that was way late. I didn't see what it was.
Personal foul. Unnecessary roughness. Deep. Automatic first down.
It's going to be a late hit on Highland Park's defense, and this is a 15-yard penalty, their first second flag of the night against the Scots.
There were three Scots converging with Denton on the Pierce running back as he went out of bounds, and somebody must have just come in just a little too late. Look at an unbalanced right look for Pierce.
Quarterback's going to keep it off to the right side. He found the seam, and he'll take it for 10 yards. He got tattooed once he got down to the 49-yard line. He's going to be about a yard shy of the first, I believe. That's Robert Ramey who came in and made the tackle for the Scots.
Just a little quarterback lead. Running back gets out in front. Quarterback smoke, keeps it. Presley Harper shows his quickness getting upfield. That was unbalanced look. Look for other formations like that to come.
First time Mustangs have been in Highland Park territory. Here's a swing pass out of the backfield, off to the left side and up the left side of the field. That's Ryan Williams, and that's Charlie Barton who finally stops him on the near sideline.
Pierce trying to take advantage and stretch the field east and west. Just a little bubble screen look. Quarterback throws what really is a lateral out to Ryan Williams, his running back, and Williams able to make some good yardage up the left sideline.
If you were watching that Harris Orthodontics replay, you saw there was a hold out there as well that did not get called. It's going to be enough for a first down from the 36 now. Here we go. Running play off to the left side. This is Baker again. Baker plays offense and defense. He's down to the 29-yard line before he's rolled up. 7:47 to play in the first quarter. We have no score between J.J. Pierce and Highland Park.
Pierce is coming again right that last play with an unbalanced look to the left, which is setting up the quarterback keeper or Wildcat keeper anyway. And assuming at some point they're going to fake that up in the line and then raise up and throw off of it. Unbalanced once again.
Ryan Williams in the backfield. Now the entire offense is going to set. They're going to go heavy the right side. That's the wide side of the field. This time it's going to be a Wildcat formation. They snap it back to Christian Baker, and he tries to get around the right side. But Tommy Rossley is there, and we've got a flag thrown as well.
Good job by Rossley coming up and taking Baker's legs out from under him. He had to really stretch out to do
it. Offense, number 50, 10-yard penalty. Replay second down.
That's going to be against the right tackle, Miguel Velasquez.
Yeah, he had to hold right there on the Highland Park defensive end, or would have been dead in the backfield a lot sooner.
Second down and 13 after they mark off the penalty yardage. Two penalties now by each team. From the Highland Park 39-yard line, here go the Mustangs. They'll send a man in motion. That's Caden Varner.
Here we go.
Here goes the defense, and they swallow up the quarterback back in midfield. Charlie Barton is the first man to get there in this quarterback sack, brought to you by Advantage Healthcare Systems. They are here to help traumatically injured individuals, whether it's on the job or in a significant accident.
Whoa, Barton came like a rocket off the offensive left side, and quarterback Presley Harper had no shot right there because he's getting help from inside, but Barton seals the fate of Presley Harper.
Two sacks for Highland Park in less than 6 minutes of play, and that is the first on the season for Charlie Barton.
Well, he got there in a hurry.
It is third and pack a lunch from midfield.
Here comes
the blitz.
We've
got to get all the way down to the 26-yard line, and we've got a flag. Somebody jumped, and they'll move it back another 5 yards.
And that was caused by Robert Ramey.
Prior to the foul start. Timeout. Pierce, first charge of the first half.
That was caused by Robert Ramey and Rossley stepping up. They didn't get the procedure call. They did make force Pierce to call a first down.
We need to step aside. We'll take a quick break, but we're going to let you continue to watch the program. Again, no score. We're in the first quarter, Highland Park and J.J. Pierce.
Partners reflects who we are and how we treat our customers. At Residential Capital Partners, we're dedicated to helping our customers build wealth through real estate. Residential Capital Partners, America's private lender.
You need to go to the restroom.
We are back after the timeout. You got to look at Jay Ellis and Owen Marie right there, just as we were in the break for a moment. Here we go.
Third and 25 or so, 24.
Yep, third and 24. Mustangs, straight drop back. Quarterback's looking for somewhere to go. Oh. He's got no place to go, and he's going to get hit hard. Judge Ellis is among those in there. William White was in there. Kyle Carlson was in there. There was a lot of people who got in there and got part of that sack.
Well, Judge Ellis at the nose position. Again, quick pressure by Carlson. Gets an inside move. Again, can't make the play, though, but he does force the quarterback up in the pocket where William White and Judge Ellis and company able to finish him off. And the Highland Park defense continues to put massive pressure on Presley Harper.
Second time tonight that Noah Self has come out and had to punt the ball away. Let's see what's going to happen this time. They interfered with the return man last time. This time the ball will just roll dead inside the 15-yard line, and Highland Park is going to get it back for the second time tonight. Scots will start deep in their own territory. We've got no score. Jay Ellis along the sidelines tonight. And, Jay, you know, the weather's a little cooler than normal down there. It's kind of hot here in the press box. How are things down there?
You know, these players probably think it's hot. When they're running around, they don't think about it. They're tough. But Owen and I over here, we're a little bit chilly. We're not hey, running around. But it's not bad.
Make Owen run some sprints down there.
Yeah, Owen and I will be running some sprints at halftime.
Our sideline reports are brought to you by Willow Bend Mortgage, your home for a way better mortgage. There's a pass to Grayson Schrank. He caught it and sneaks up out to the 25-yard line, 26-yard line.
First down, Jason Schrank, just a little curl-in stopper out there. And, again, Schrank is so difficult to cover because his speed can take you deep. If he hesitates and then turns and goes past, he'll blow right past you.
Schrank comes into the game, the leading receiver yards-wise with 518 receiving yards this season. Averages almost 16 yards a catch. Play action, score to go long. Has a receiver down there, that's Bo Lilly. He's going to take it to the 20, and Lilly's going to take it to the house. Bo Lilly on the catch and run and touchdown. 74 yards for Highland Park's first touchdown of the night.
What a beautiful pass right there by Brennan Storr. He gets great protection up front, the perfect pocket to throw from, able to step and throw, and Lilly's about 5 yards behind the defender for an easy Highland Park touchdown.
That replay brought to you by Harris Orthodontics. The touchdown brought to you by Bob Lilly Promotions.
How appropriate.
Here we go with the extra point brought to you by Brett Kennedy, Peter McGuire with Kensington Vanguard National title that kicks up and on the way, and it is good by Jake Tansey. And the Scots have jumped out to a 7-0 lead with 4:31 to play in the first quarter, and we'll take a timeout when we come back. Kickoff, Highland Park and the Mustangs in a 7-0 Scots lead.
Baker Brothers replay. Team Baker Brothers really stopped that running toilet in its tracks. No more running toilets.
Now that's what I call a bathroom break.
Okay, Jimmy.
Call now to get this month's great deal from
Scots get on the board first with that long touchdown throw just a moment ago. So Highland Park, we talked a little bit about not allowing any big plays last week, and they defined big plays by 20 yards or more. Who on Highland Park's team has the most 20-yard plays? Now, I'm not counting Brennan Storr passing. I'm talking receiving or running.
I'd say Jay Cox.
And Jay Ellis, who would you say?
I would say Jay Cox, but if not, then it's Luke Herring. Yeah.
No, it is not. It is Bo Lilly. That's his seventh catch of the season for 20 yards or more.
So when he catches them, they're big plays.
They're big plays. Our kickoff brought to you by Davidson Bogle Real Estate. Land is their business, and kickoffs are the business of Regus. He's going to send this one into the end zone. They'll down it and bring it out to the 25-yard line. Let's get another look at that touchdown catch by Bo Lilly just a moment ago. Brennan Storr puts it on the money.
Watch the protection. Well, pretty pocket.
Watch the catch. He didn't break stride. Bo is gone. That's going to be his fourth touchdown catch of the season. And for Brennan Storr, that's going to be touchdown throw number 23 on the season. It's going to put him over 2,000 yards passing as well.
And, Russell, here's that drive recap from the Scots. It was an impressive look. Let's run this play, and then I'll give it to you right after this play.
Mustangs from their own 25-yard line.
Unbalanced right.
They're going to turn, and they're going to hand it off. Right up the middle goes Ryan Williams. He'll bring this out for about 4 yards, maybe 5 yards. That's going to be Ramey who gets in there and makes the tackle for the Highland Park Scots.
And here's that drive recap, Russell. Scots go 86 yards in two plays, take 46 seconds off the clock. The touchdown, 74-yard pass from Brennan Storer to Bo Lilly. Tansy adds the extra point. And with 4:31 to go in the first quarter, it's Highland Park 7 and Pierce nothing. Drive recap brought to you by Stewart Partners Global Advisory.
Quarterback wants to swing it out to the left side. It's going to be caught. No place to go. Quick, nice defensive play made by Adam Rourke over there. That's actually going to go for a loss of one on the play. That was Caden Varner who made the catch.
And Rourke, showing his expertise at raking the ball free, carries Varner out of bounds. And right before he hits the sideline, he's raking that ball free. And he'll get one of those before long for the Scots. Here comes the heat.
Here come. They show blitz, and then they back out of it. They bring Judge Ellis off the left side. And the rollout to the left is going to be thrown and caught on the far side of the field. And this is going to go for a first down. And I'm trying to get the guy who caught it right there. It's going to be Jake McCary, number 5. And Brady Dotrieve, who comes in there and makes the tackle.
Well, Presley Harper is running for his life out to the right side. Again, Judge Ellis in heavy pursuit and is able to find McGarry. And here comes the reverse.
Here's the reverse. This is going to be to Varner. Varner trying to get around the edge, and he's going to get hit, and he's going to get slammed out of bounds on the near side. Coming up off the bottom of that pile for the Scots is Barrett Denton. Makes the tackle, but it's going to be a pickup of 6 yards.
And just one of many trick plays that we are going to see tonight, I'm sure. Barrett Denton coming out of that secondary, again, like a bolt of lightning. He really closed fast.
Barrett's got 43 tackles on the season with that one. Second down and 4. Here we go. Handoff. Williams isn't going to get it. Got his feet caught and pulled down. That's Sam Morris. Made the tackle right there. Sam now leads the team in tackles with 62. He had 10 tackles in last week's game alone.
And you know, Russell, the coaches give points to players based on what they do, not just tackles, but how they, you know, if their steps are right, so forth. And Morris last week, anything over 20 points is remarkable. Morris last week, I believe, was 25.
Third down. Here we go. Trying to run around the left side, and they'll get the first down. As they'll crash it all the way down to the 38-yard line. On the carry there is Christian Baker. On the tackle, Robert Ramey again. We've called his name several times. Charlie Barton was in on the tackle as well.
Right there, number 97, Henry Richter almost had him in the backfield. Can't quite hold on, and Pierce running back's able to push forward for the first down. All right, Russell, unbalanced look we've seen. Unbalanced right once again for the Pierce Mustangs.
Quarterback turns right side. He's going to keep it himself and picked up. He pitched it off to Baker. And it is going to be a pickup of about 3-4 yards. William White's over there to make the tackle. Mike McAbee corrects me and says it is a full 5-yard pickup.
Yeah, it looks like that Pierce is going to be committed with that unbalanced look to running the quarterback lead or Wildcat power, just pounding the ball up inside.
Here we go with an option play. They'll go to inside with the option this time, and it's going to be to Baker again. And Baker has got the first down as he ran right behind that big 300-pound left guard.
Well, and that's a play that, if you recall, Tim Tebow made four famous in Florida, running the option, but you have two options. You can either pitch it backwards or you can pitch it forward. That time, Presley goes forward with it, puts a lot of pressure on the defense to cover both of them.
This time, the quarterback will keep it. A design quarterback draw will get inside the 25 to near the 24. Judge Ellis is the first man to make contact and bring him down. It's going to be just a 2-yard pickup. Don't forget, coming up during our post-game show tonight, we will interview our defensive player of the game. Still not sure who it's going to be yet, but that defensive player of the game is brought to you by HP Youth Football, preparing tomorrow's Scots today. 10th play of the drive coming up right here for the Mustangs. It's gone 50 yards so far. And almost 3 minutes of the clock. We're inside a minute to play in the quarter. There's going to be an inside. No, they fake the inside handoff. Quarterback keeps it, and he's going to get down very close to that first down marker. William White among those in on the tackle for the Scots.
And Pierce find a little success running the ball inside, but they're going the heavy lineup to do it. That time you had two sniffer backs almost right behind the right guard, and Pierce fakes the stretch sweep and then pulls it out on the Pluto play, and here's short yardage. Scott's got to get low.
They're going to bunch everybody up tight, let the quarterback take it himself. Did he make it? I'm not sure if he did. Well, from where they're looked like they're going to spot it, he may have made it. Needed less than a yard, and now they say first down.
Great job by Cormac Carroll cutting the guard's center's knees out. He goes way low. They don't get much movement at all, but then again, they didn't need much.
That is the sixth first down tonight for the Pierce Mustangs. Timeout's going to be taken right here as we are at the end of the first quarter. Highland Park's got a 7-0 lead. We'll head into the second quarter, but first, let's take this timeout.
Swole is fantastic. You feel you're involved in every step of the decision-making process. That really makes a big difference to me.
Discover our wide variety of new and certified pre-owned vehicles at Swole Cadillac or SwoleCadillac.com.
Headed to the second quarter now, Highland Park with a 7-0 lead on J.J. Pierce. Russell Scott along with Jim Castellaw, Jay Ellis along the sideline. Pat Sauer is with us again tonight. Mike McAbee, our statistician. Yvonne Zuniga, our in-booth producer.
And Russell, I want to give a shout-out to some of our biggest fans. Well, first of all, Mary John Bass. She has listened for years. She's raised four H.P. Scotts. Mike, Carey, Marcy, and Kathy listens every week. She's got grandkids, if you remember Brant Green. Bryce
yep.
Green,
yep.
They played here at Highland Park, Elise, and then also Michael and Kelsey Bass. But Mary John, from what I understand, she is in front of the TV every week, and really appreciate you watching and listening to us, Mary John. Also, I want to give a shout-out to Hoss Allen, Coach Allen's dad. He's 98 years old, listening in Abilene. We appreciate all the folks out there far and wide listening to Scott's football as we get ready for the playoffs.
Didn't he have a birthday last week?
He did. Sugar huddle, here we go.
Here we go, hand it off. The running play around the left side. This is going to be Varner, who's trying to turn the corner, gets to the boundary, ball comes out, but he was already out of bounds. And Robert Ramey and Jack Morris are the two that forced him out of bounds. Move the ball 3 yards, and second down and 7 coming up. You get a good look at it right here.
And that's a quick jet sweep around that left end by Caden Varner. Anytime you see Pierce go to that sugar huddle like they did right there, you better be ready. Trick play coming.
Here we go. You get a look at us here in the booth there for just a second. That's probably all you need is just a second. Here we go. Running play goes around the right side. There's Yvonne Zuniga back there. There's Jim Castellaw right there. Mike McAbee's right here.
There you go.
And
Jay's on the sideline. Here's sugar.
We'll get a look at Jay here in just a couple of minutes.
Oh,
third
nice.
Down and very short yardage.
Oh, wait a minute. Ball may be loose.
I don't know if they got it. I don't think they did. Official holds up number four.
Yep, fourth down.
It is going to be a fourth down situation. They do not convert the third down.
And the Scott's defense lives for situations like this. You know, you say you'd rather not get in that position, but when they do, it looks like Pierce may be at least lining up for the field goal, but I would be careful about the fake situation here. Again, Pierce doesn't have anything to lose. They're going to throw it all out there.
Jake Shaddle to kick the field goal. It'll be a 25-yard attempt from the right hash mark. He puts his foot into it, and he splits the uprights, and J.J. Pierce is on the board. It's a 7-3 game now. And Highland Park still with the advantage, but the Mustangs finally get some points on the board.
Right, and Pierce has been finding some success running the ball up inside, and again trying to force Highland Park to commit more of their secondary to stopping it, which eventually the Scots will do, but you still have to be able to cover deep as well. I remember Mac Ballard in an interview saying, yeah, we're always going to cover pass first, but at some point you got to come up and help on the run.
Receivers for three, Jackson Heights, 53,
Well, the Scots up 7-3, 10-16 to play. Coming up at halftime, we will have our player profile. Who'd you talk to this week?
Talked to Will Ogle, a sophomore offensive guard for the Scots, as well as Ethan Burt, who is a cornerback for the Scots, and also Coach Chip Burt's son. Coach Burt is the defensive line coach for the Scots. His son is in the secondary, a cornerback playing for Coach Smith. And we had some interesting conversations about what's it like to not only be coached on the field by your coach, but then be coached by your dad on the way home every night.
My dad was my principal.
Oh, well, then you know what it feels like.
I understand that. And then my mom was my English teacher in the sixth grade. So, by the way, that's coming up during our Madden Securities Global Capabilities from People You Trust, our Madden Securities halftime show. Is there... I got a B in English. No, I think I got an A minus in English, and everybody thought it was because my mom gave me all the answers. It's Colin Sewell on the return right here off of our Davidson Bogle Real Estate kickoff, and Sewell will bring it out to near the 35-36 yard line.
So, did you ever get sent to your dad?
I did.
Did you?
I did.
For misbehaving?
Well, what the teacher thought was misbehaving. I didn't think it was misbehaving.
You were being creative.
Creative, yes. The bad part is, and Ethan can tell you the same thing, you get it at school and then you get it at home
well. I'm sure, yeah. His dad said he'd get more if he didn't sleep on the way home. But. Jay, we'll get to that in a minute here.
If you could just hear what Jay Ellis is saying. Here we go. Highland Park's got
nice
it. They're going to hand
push.
It off. This is going to be Wilson Axley going over the right side. Nice follow through on the fake by Brennan Storer right there as well. But Axley on the carry for Highland Park. He gets another 5 yards.
And Case Pickleman right there. You'll see him get a drive block. Watch him drive number 9. Watch Basso and Watts. Do the same. Good push by the Highland Park offensive line.
That replay brought to you by the Rustic. Here is a wide open Luke Herring. He makes the catch. And it is down to the 35. He'll get it down to the 30 and into near the 29-yard line. Ethan Hunt finally made the tackle. But a beautiful route that was run. He was wide open and Storer hit him.
Look at Herring shut down in the soft spot of the zone, and Storer put the ball right there where it needs to be.
Replays this quarter brought to you by Free Range Concepts, the Rustic, Texas ingredients, Texas sounds, Texas soul. Storer has now gone over 100 yards passing here in the early part of the second quarter. On first down, Storer to throw again. Across the middle, that's going to be caught. That's Bo Lilly who makes the catch. He'll be tackled right about the 13-yard line. Another first down for the Scots. And in to make the tackle is Linus Leatherwood.
Yep, Bo Lilly again. Good protection. Pierce comes with a blitz. And Scott's offensive line, along with help from the running back, I believe that was actually... picks it up and allows Storer to get the ball to Lilly.
Here we go inside the Shelby American red zone. Highland Park on a first down situation. Axley's going to take the handoff. Started right, cut back left. And not a lot of running room right there as he runs into a couple of red jerseys. I'm sorry, it was Frank Musa who carried the ball right there for Highland Park. And a 1 yard pickup. His first carry of the night for Frank, who last week had... Three carries, two touchdowns.
Not a bad average right there. And again, three-man front with the outside backers coming from the outside in stabber stunts.
Straight drop back. Storer's
nice.
Got all day.
Nice.
Now he's going to be flushed out of the pocket. Runs off to the right side. Throws on the run as a receiver. Is it caught?
Yep.
Touchdown. Highland Park.
Oh.
Took a while for the official to make the call. That's going to be a 12-yard touchdown throw, and Bo Lilly gets his second touchdown catch of the night.
Watch right here the protection. Storer has a ton of time. Herring's dragging across the end zone, but it's Lilly that Storer finds on a little route. Starts inside, comes back to the outside.
Touchdowns brought to you by Bob Lilly Promotions, proudly supporting the Scots since 1999. And here comes Jake Tansey trying to tack on the extra point. It's brought to you by Kensington Vanguard National Title. Brett Kennedy, Peter McGuire, our thanks to you for being part of the broadcast. Kicks up and on the way, and the PAT is G-O-O-D. It's a 14-3 lead now for Highland Park. 7:53 to play in the first half.
Boy, you know, Bo Lilly started off the year slowly. He didn't get a lot of catches early, but he has really turned the heat up late here in the year. Watch this replay right here. Store where Lilly comes inside, sees the scramble, circles back to the outside, and because he runs the scramble drill so well with his quarterback Store, he's got a touchdown.
And again, those replays brought to you by The Rustic, Texas Ingredients, Texas Sounds, Texas Soul. It's all part of the free range concepts.
Russell, that scoring drive for the Scots, let's go over that. As they go 68 yards in five plays, take 2 minutes and 23 seconds off the clock. The touchdown, a 12-yard pass, scramble pass from Brennan Storr to Bo Lilly. Tansy adds the extra point, and with 7:53 to go in the half, it's Highland Park 14, Pierce 3. This drive recap is brought to you by Steward Partners Global Advisory, located right here in Dallas. Again, that's Steward Partners Global Advisory. We thank you for your support of Highland Park football.
Bo Lilly, 103 yards receiving tonight already, and two touchdowns to go along with that. Our kickoff brought to you by Davidson Bogle Real Estate. Land is their business. Regas steps into it, and it's going to be a short, high kick. Bounces at about the 18-yard line and goes out of bounds.
Pierce will get it at the 30.
Kick goes out of bounds.
7:53 to go, 14-3, our score. Highland Park leads. Again, the game, if you didn't just tuning in or something, you're wondering how could it only be the second quarter. Move kickoff back an hour because of the weather today. All of the rain, all of the high winds and everything have moved off into East Texas, so we're going to be dry the rest of the night and right on through most of next week, I believe.
Yeah, and I think everybody will be ready for a nice, pleasant Friday game without any thunderstorms. Scott's got Spencer Brown, Montgomery, and Carlson in defensive front.
Mustangs, pass play. A little look-in pattern from the left side. That's going to be caught. It's going to be about 7 yards. And Blake Follett will make the catch. His first catch of the night.
That's Hunter Thornton coming in to make the play in an outside linebacker.
Second down and three. They'll tighten up the formation just a bit. Highland Park with that three-man defensive line situation and trying to run right through the middle of it, and they do. First down's going to be made. Coming in to make the tackle for Highland Park is Brady Dotrieve, but not before Mustangs get the first down as they get it all the way down to the 42-yard line.
Pierce going with a little power football, just trying to pound it up inside and try to break a tackle. Scots are there to make the hit in the hole, but they didn't finish it off.
Here we go. This time, Harper rolls to the right side, throws, catch is made, but the tackle is made immediately. Coming in there for the Scots is Mac Ballard, who had the interception for a touchdown last week. Gets his first. It was called back. Well, it was still. He almost had a touchdown.
We're going to count it. Yeah, it was a touchdown run by Mac.
Mike McAbee's always got to be correcting me on stuff like
nice.
That. Boy, there is a nice tackle right there by Jack Morris. He stepped in there and brought the running back. Hunter Thornton had the first hit.
Watch the backer step up and fill the hole. Great job right there. You didn't get a good shot of it, but William White setting the edge, forcing everything back to the inside. But Hunter Thornton doing a heck of a job right there.
Going with two running backs this time. They're heavy set to the right this time. Turn, handed off, running play. Not a whole lot there. They only needed 2 yards. They're only going to get 1 yard, so fourth down now for the Mustangs.
And watch Highland Park shift. You see Montgomery go low. Right there, stuff the center. And, again, Pierce's running backs are doing a good job being patient, and it's forcing Highland Park to do the same. Fourth and one. Let's see if the Scots can shut down Pierce right here, turn the ball over.
That was Ryan Williams running the ball. Here we go on fourth down situation. They're going to hand it off, and they did just get the first down. They didn't need much, but they got just enough. Ryan Williams on the carry. He'll pick up two. William White is in there. Brady Dotrieve is in there as well. Get a look at it here on the replay brought to you by the Rustic.
Pierce going with a little tempo, set up to go.
Here we go on first down. Play action. They'll throw it. And the little look in to Caden Varner is no good. He can't hold on to it. Had he caught it, you had Mac Ballard, who was drawing a bead on him and might have taken his head off if he would have caught that.
Mac Ballard trying to make up for lost ground. He was unfortunately hurt for the first part, good part of the season, and came back in. Jesuit gradually gained more and more playing time, and he's starting to make a name for himself now for the Scots.
Second down and 10 after the incomplete pass. Snap it back. Quarterback rolls off to the left side. Harper wants to throw and does throw, and it is going to be incomplete. Carlson jumped up there and knocked the ball. Incomplete. It was Kyle Carlson.
Yep. Kyle, he's got the definite height to do it. Watch him right here. Get his hands up. Tip it. Force the ball to go incomplete. If you can't get there, get your hands up. And Carlson, with his height, is a formidable defensive lineman to get the ball over for quarterback. Passing situation, third and 10. Judge Ellis moves in at nose guard now to get some pressure up the middle. Carlson and Spencer Brown on the outside.
Mustangs only 3 for 7, converting third downs tonight, trying to set up a screen pass, and they do. Pass is going to be complete down at the 48-yard line. They'll take it across the 40, down to the 38-yard line. Coming in to make the tackle is Juellen Roberts. And for the Scots, among those in there is Carl Williams.
There you see the screen setting up. Judge Ellis smells it out one way. Look at the effort right there from Hunter Thornton coming back to the offensive right side, and then Carl Williams up to make the hit.
Fourth down now for the Mustangs.
Here we go.
Two wide receivers. They've got everybody tight. Fake the handoff. Quarterback's going to keep it. He got hit. I don't think he made it. He did not get it. Highland Park did a great job. Morris is there. Rossley is there. And a couple of more white jerseys. And they have turned away the Mustangs.
They see the double sniffer. They try to lead up in there. But watch Morris come in, make first contact. And Rossley, his buddy, is there to clean him up with help from the rest of the defense. And the Scots have done their job on the defensive side of the ball.
Mustangs turn it over on downs. And a big part of our broadcast tonight is Dr. Heinrich of Hilltop Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. Thank you to Dr. Heinrich for being part of Highland Park football.
Let's see if Coach Allen goes deep right off the bat on this turnover on downs.
There's Coach Allen right there. Here we go. Storer wants to throw, and he is going to go deep across the middle. It was tipped and almost intercepted. Intended for Grayson Schrank. That was Ryan Williams, the starting running back, who's in at safety. Plays both ways, starts both ways, and he almost had an interception right there.
And I can't tell you how long it's been since we've seen Brennan Storer throw any ball a little bit high. You know, I think he's entitled to that. Yep. He's been so steady and so reliable about putting the ball where it needs to be on the money.
How much of that is the wind? He's going into stiff southeast wind right now. Here he goes on a play action, throws off to the right side. It's going to be incomplete. And again, that one's going to be a little too tall. Jackson Heiss, the intended receiver.
And it's seldom too tall for Jackson Heiss.
That's right.
That one was a little bit. And like you say, Russell, Scots are going into that wind from the north right now, and so that may be affecting Brennan's throws just a little bit.
Scots are 0-for-1 on third down conversions. Let's see what they do right here. Normally, Highland Park's 44% on converting third downs.
Five men coming.
Straight drop back. Storer's got some time. Now he's going to step up, swings it out near side. Axley makes a catch and has the first down and a lot more. Wilson Axley into Mustang territory down to the 38-yard line.
And a tremendous job by Brennan Storer. Keeping his composure, the pocket starts to break down. He wants to go upfield. It's not there where he wants it. He feels he's got to get out of there. But instead of running, he sees Axley out of the corner of his eye to the left and dishes the ball out for what will be a big first down for the Scots out in front blocking Luke Herring.
Only the fifth catch of the season for Wilson Axley, and that one went for 24 yards. There's another pass. It's a little bit high, intended for Bo Lilly, who was open. And that's going to go down as an incomplete pass. Wilson Axley, by the way, had four catches for 50 yards coming into the game. That one went for 24.
And he is so fast that he's going to, if you dish the ball out to him, we've seen it from Jay Cox all year. And because of that, we haven't got to see actually what he can do. But he's got a whole new set of talents out there. Cox does his thing, actually got it too. Here comes a blitz.
Three receivers split out to the right. That's the top of your screen as you watch. They're going to swing it out into the flat right side. Caught by Lilly. He'll turn it upfield. Goes out of bounds, but he didn't go real easily. He has to be pushed out by two different defenders. And he'll step out at the 32. And Clark Wilson, outside backer, get credit for the tackle. There's one. Finally, Wilson able to stop the play.
That's on the drive. 3:26 to go in the half. Four-man front, even front. Ogle talked about it. Oh, yes.
Second time on this drive, Highland Park converts the third down, and Wilson Axley is going to be tackled right at the 25. He'll mark him down at the 26. Randy Hernandez comes in to make the tackle. Hernandez leads this team in tackling with 68 on the season.
Good inside seal right time. Shots running the power play, and big Jake Watts, number 65, leading up through the hole. Got to spin real quickly back to his left to seal off the backer, but he does so, and he allows Scott's running back to get the first down.
Axley comes out. Musa stays in for Highland Park. Play being signaled in from the sideline right now.
Sugar huddle.
Two receivers to either side for the Scots. Storr wants to throw. Now he's flushed out of the pocket. Storr running for his life. Reverses again.
Again.
Now
here we go.
He's got a little bit of time. He looks downfield. He'll tuck it and run with it. Probably a good idea right there. And he may be getting the first down.
Oh, nice effort by Brendan Storr.
See where he's going to spot the ball. He ran a long ways, but he's really close to the first down marker.
Watch this right here again. Heavy pressure. Storr running for his life back in the backfield, reverses, and he puts the defensive backs in a terrible situation because they've got to cover the Scots receivers downfield or Storr will get there. So Brendan just takes off and runs and picks up the first down.
He did not pick up the first down.
They're
going to say he's
second
one. Just
a smidge.
That's the word I was looking for. Oh, no. There's Storr getting hit. He throws, and he's just going to get rid of this one. Let's see. Are they going to call it an incomplete pass, or was he in the grass?
Grayson Schrank was running off to the right, so the ball was thrown in his direction. So it's not intentional grounding by any means. So I think they're going to give that Brennan an incomplete pass. Did a nice job of keeping the play alive and refusing to take the sack.
Scots have converted two third downs on this drive. Let's see if they can get a third right here. It's third and one.
Again, up front, Pickleman. Watts, Maroulis, Basso, Sweeney.
Out of the gun, Storr. Fakes a handoff, swings it out right side. That's going to be caught, and it is going to be a first down. Jackson Heiss. Heiss leans down to the 15-yard line. Ryan Williams is there to make the tackle. And the Scots move the chains again. Their third first down on this drive alone.
Again, just a little over 2 minutes to go in the half. Scots knocking on the door. Sees that momentum big time if they can get in here.
In the Shelby red zone one more time for Highland Park. Let's see what they do right here. Scots in the red zone converting at a rate of 92% this year. Pass, right side. That's caught. That's Heiss. Nice catch. Steps out of bounds at about the 8. And he had a linebacker on him, and that was Rhett Sawyer, who finally gets credit for the tackle after 7-yard pickup.
Well, Heiss or Herring run a little out route. There's no defending it because you get up there on them, they're going to take you deep. And if you back off, it's going to be an easy pitch and catch.
Second down and two. Scots can get a first down. 11th play of the drive. Storr on a quarterback draw. He will not get the first down. He'll lose one. Tackled at the 9-yard line, and a late flag comes in.
I thought there was a hole over there on the right side behind Basso, and Storr can't get out of the grasp of the Pierce defensive line. Let's see if it's a late hit.
Personal foul. Unnecessary roughness. Defense number 35. Penalty being enforced. Half distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
And that, Russell, that penalty is against Randy Hernandez, who's I believe the Pierce leading tackler on the year with 68 tackles.
Yep, Highland Park will be set up with a first and goal to go. Put the ball down at the four-yard line. Scott's bringing two running backs in there. This is going to be Axley and Musa. Here we go. Frank Musa. In at the five. He'll grind his way down to about the 2.5. He's going to have his feet taken out from under him. Luke Stotts, the nose guard.
Yeah, Pierce got big-time penetration in the A-gap, and that's going to destroy any play right there.
Don't forget, coming up on our post-game show tonight, our post-game show is brought to you by Burger House. And during the post-game show, we'll interview our special teams player of the game. That's brought to you by Mark Clifton Homes, trusted builder of exceptional homes. And our thanks to Mark Clifton Homes for being a sponsor of Highland Park football. Well, maybe not the margin you would have expected at this point, but the Scots have a pretty comfortable 14-3 lead.
Right, and they've controlled the tempo. Give Pierce credit. They've found something they can hang their hat on a little bit with the inside runs out of the unbalanced look in the offensive line. But, again, with Scots, they can really seize control of this whole game if they can punch the ball in here before half.
This is going to be the 12th play of the drive. Prior to this, Highland Park had 11 total plays. So this is the 12th play of this drive.
Oh, easy.
And it's a throw into the end zone for the touchdown to Grayson Schrank. As Grayson Schrank makes his, that's going to be his fifth touchdown catch of the season.
Oh, easy pitch and catch right there. Brennan Storr takes the snap, immediately sprints out hard to his left, and Schrank just runs a little out route from his left slot position. And, again, we'll see the replay here shortly, but easy touchdown for the Scots.
Extra point coming up right here. Stepping into it and kicking it is Jake Tansey. And Jake Tansey splits the uprights. That extra point brought to you by Kensington Vanguard National Title.
There you see Jet Grayson Schrank with an easy touchdown for the Scots, 21-3.
That's what's so great about these outside receivers and inside receivers. They all can get the job done. We need to take a break. Again, our score, 21-3. Highland Park leads the J.J. Pierce Mustangs.
Determination on the field breeds determination in life. Discipline needed on the court will be the same discipline that gets the job done. That's why Tailwater Capital is a proud supporter of the Highland Park Athletic Program, the winningest athletic program in the state of Texas. 11 Lone Star Cups, 112 state championships, and a commitment to excellence that serves its players for a lifetime. From the locker room to the boardroom, Scots find a way.
Hey, you look at a look at number two right there. That's Grayson Schrank, who just had that touchdown catch a moment ago. Our kickoff being brought to you by Davidson Bogle Real Estate. And deep to do the return chores, McGarry and Varner for the Mustangs. They'll stand back at the 10-yard line.
We'll get that drive recap right after this kickoff for Highland Park.
Nicholas Regas puts a foot into it. Again, it's going to be a high short kick. This is going to be fielded around the 22-yard line, brought out to the 25, 26, 27-yard line. And I believe that was Caden Varner on the return.
Right.
Excuse me, it was Jack McGarry on the return.
Let's go over that drive recap, Russell. Scots go 62 yards in 13 plays, take 3 minutes and 10 seconds off the clock. Touchdown, a 3-yard pass from Brennan Storr to Grayson Schrank. Tadsey once again adds the extra point, and with a minute 15 to go in the half, it's Highland Park 21, Pierce 3. This drive recap brought to you by Steward Partners Global Advisory. That's Steward Partners Global Advisory.
Here we go on a first down. Ball's going to be put down at the 27-yard line. Here's Ryan Williams on the carry. He'll get out across the 35 near the 36 before he's going to be tackled. William White among those in on the tackle. Also is there Cormac Carroll. Comes in to help out.
Cormac's been doing a good job at nose guard, him and Lewis Montgomery.
Inside a minute to play in the first half. Again,
oh, yes.
Handoff goes up the middle. They'll pick up the first down, but there's not much room. William White, again, in on the tackle. William came into the game with 59 tackles this season.
He has been just outstanding, and to nobody's surprise, he was one of the hardest workers this summer in the weight room and with performance course. You know, his success is earned.
This time Harper to throw, looks left side, and it's going to be caught over on the far side of the field, right around the 45-yard line. I believe that's Blake Follett who made the catch.
Right.
And was that McGarry? Jake McGarry who made the catch. Hunter Thornton was defending on the play. No, it was Blake Follett who made the catch. And second down and 5. 27 seconds to go now in the first half. This time, Harper rolls to the right side, wants to throw. Rares back, throws into double coverage. It's incomplete, trying to get it down there to Roberts. Highland Park had two players back there defending. Wes Giese was there, and Carl Williams was the other.
Well, you see Coach Leidner, he's got a spy on the quarterback, Harper. I mean, again, when Harper starts to sprint out, Rossley makes a beeline for him and forces him to throw before he wants to, but good coverage that time by the two Highland Park defenders.
Third down coming up right here. They move the tailback right behind the quarterback out of this formation.
Little pistol.
On third down, now everybody turns. Play's being signaled in from the Mustang sideline.
Judge Ellis in at nose guard again.
Highland Park
Spencer
brings
Brown.
An outside linebacker up. Here comes the rush. They're setting up a screen pass, not incomplete. Ryan Williams dropped it, and that's going to bring fourth down. 17 seconds to go now, and Highland Park...
Now, Scott's
got a little bit of an opportunity right here going into the wind here in the second quarter.
Let's see. This is the senior punt block. Let's see if they can block this punt and give the Scots a chance to kick a field goal before half. This is, I think, the Berserkers right here, and they've been given the green light most of the time to go block it if they can. Let's see what kind of pressure they can get or what kind of return they can run. I think Pierce recognized that they may be
Pierce.
Looking at heavy
second
pressure from the Scots.
Half.
Pierce, because of that, takes timeout.
We've got a timeout on the field with 17 seconds to play, and Julian Pham Davis will be returning the punts tonight. That's because Jay Cox not playing tonight. Not so much a big injury or anything, but they were just giving him the night off to get everything healthy before the playoffs start in 1 week. And the playoffs will be next Friday night at Highlander Stadium. Win, lose, or draw, Highland Park's going to be in the playoffs.
Right, and you know, again, because Highland Park is the higher seed, the district champion, 6A does just what 5A does. They get the higher seed gets a home game. So you'll see a lot of home games played on the district champion's home field. Next week.
Been a long time since Highland Park played in Arlington School. They get Bowie in the first round.
Highland Park's not hadn't been in that West Texas region, and that's where we are this year.
Here we go. Fourth down coming up right here.
By offense back on the field for Pierce. They're no longer punting.
They'll go with two running backs in the backfield.
Let's see if the quarterback backs up. Harper's backing up, looks like, to punt anyway.
Harper will take two steps back. Nobody deep for Highland Park.
Oh.
They almost blocked that. And this one's going to bounce and roll. It's going to take a Mustang roll all the way down inside the 10-yard line. Highland Park will have 5 seconds to 4 seconds to work with.
I'm sure we'll see the knee.
Now, okay, explain this to me, Coach.
Okay.
4 seconds to go.
Yep.
Why not rear back and throw it as far as you can?
I can't argue with that with the Highland Park's receivers. If you got Heiss and you got Luke Herring and you got Schrank, especially, and Lily as well, too. But do you want to, you know, if by chance the ball's picked and brought back for a touchdown, do you want to give the momentum to a Pierce team that looks like they're teetering on giving in? So I imagine we're going to see the... Victory formation. Kneel down unless Coach Allen's got something up his sleeve.
Scots will line up in that victory formation in there. They will take the knee, and that is going to bring us to halftime.
But that was a good play call.
21-3. Highland Park's got the big lead on the Mustangs, and our Madden Asset Management halftime show is just about ready to get underway, and Jim had a chance to talk to a couple of players. We'll hear from them coming up momentarily. Mike McAbee will get all his stats ready to go, and we'll take a look at those as well. But it's been a big first half for the offense for the Scots.
I believe we're going to, if I'm not mistaken, we'll see the Highland Park band and drill team first, and then the interviews after that.
And we'll take a break, and we'll do all of that coming up right after this.
With almost 100 offices across the state of Texas and 50 of them in the DFW area alone, Capital Title is here to serve you. Made by Texans, for Texans. Capital Title is the largest independent title company in the United States. We are Dallas-born, Dallas-based, and family-owned. We support the Highland Park Scots.
Show tonight brought to you by Madden Securities. Global capabilities from the people you trust. The Highland Park Marching Band is not here tonight. They are at competition out of town, but the Highland Park Bells are here, and we're going to let you watch their performance. The Highland Park Bells performing here at halftime, where the Scots have a 21-3 lead on J.J. Pierce.
I don't know. proud sponsor of the 2022 team. The Highland Bells are under the direction of Mrs. Shannon Phillips. Associate Director is Mrs. Emily Sanchez. And Assistant Director is Mrs. Berkeley Slover.
Highland Park Bells performing at halftime here tonight. The Scots have a 21-3 lead on J.J. Pierce, and our halftime show tonight brought to you by Madden Securities, global capabilities from the people you trust. Okay, first half, thoughts, comments?
Well, I think the Scots did a good job of moving the ball down the field and taking advantage of what Pierce was giving them. I think Pierce had, again, found some success running the ball and were able to keep the ball in their possession for probably longer than Highland Park would have liked it to. But, again, big fourth down play. Scots prove over and over again they can stop almost anybody, no matter how big the offensive line is, on a fourth down if they need it.
Even though Pierce got the ball to open the game, Highland Park's defense held. Scots scored first, still have not trailed at all this season.
And that's a tremendous stat advantage. Obviously, I think the Scots, if they were to ever get behind, are going to be just as capable of coming back, and getting on top again. But, again, if you can jump on somebody early, that's the way to do it. And Scots are in a district where they can do that.
Scots more than 200 yards of total offense in the first half. Brennan Storer goes over 100 yards passing in the first half, over 200 yards passing in the first half. Bo Lilly has two touchdown catches, goes over 100 yards receiving in the first half, and just the offense looked like they were on track, and the defense continues to do what they do.
Right, and again, there was Highland Park receivers. We haven't talked about this, but I think the Highland Park receivers are some of the best they have ever had. At least that, normally you get five or six receivers who have rotated in and out. Well, these, not that there aren't capable receivers behind these guys, but these guys are such, capable receivers and good at what they do that, I just don't think I've seen this Highland Park have this good a set of four receivers in quite some time.
Scots came into the game averaging 248 yards passing, and they're on track to beat that tonight. And again, up 21-3. We need to take a timeout. When we come back, we'll listen in on our player profiles, and you had a chance to catch up with a couple of more guys. Who are we going to hear from tonight?
Will Ogle and Ethan Burt. And kind of interesting stories with them. Ogle, a sophomore, hearing about his experiences on the offensive line, and Burt, hearing about his experiences with his dad being a coach.
Our Madden Securities halftime show rolls on in just a moment, but first we'll take a break with our score at halftime. Highland Park 21, Pierce 3.
In the end, it's not the politician that builds this country. It's the entrepreneur carrying the world's largest economy on their shoulders, putting Americans back to work. Really, they're the only ones who ever could. We've always been the entrepreneur's bank for the century behind and the century ahead. Vista Bank. Entrepreneurs. Banking entrepreneurs. Since 1912.
It's the Baker Brothers replay. Team Baker Brothers scored a big one with this touchdown tune-up.
That unit sure has some cool moves.
I'll admit it, Jimmy. That's one super shuffle.
Free smart home thermostat with a new Linux AC system.
Attention Highland Park Scots and SMU fans. Football is back at Highlander and on the Hilltop. And so is your favorite neighborhood burger joint, Goff's Hamburgers. It's the same burgers, same fries, hot dogs, and chicken you loved as a kid, but now in a brand new location. Goff's is now on Mockingbird between SMU and Central Expressway. Drop in for that unmistakable charcoal grill taste. Host a private party in the back room, or hang out and enjoy the Highland Park and SMU memories hanging on the walls. Goff's Hamburgers, proud supporter of the Highland Park Scots. Well, again, at halftime, the Scots are up 21-3, and in that first half, Highland Park had 226 yards of total offense to 130 for J.J. Pierce. Pierce, though, ran 38 offensive plays. Highland Park only ran 25 offensive plays, and yet the Scots have an big lead.
Which we see over and over again. Highland Park does not need a lot of plays to put points on the board. But Pierce doing what a lot of teams want to do, which is keep the ball away from the Highland Park offense.
Let's take a look at some of the highlights from that first half tonight.
There you go. Sack by Charlie Barton coming like a rocket from the left side.
Here's that big touchdown catch for Bo Lilly.
He was behind the defender by a good 8 yards.
Another look at it right here.
15.
Bo Lilly, who's had more plays of 20 yards or more than any other Highland Park Scott offensive player.
Well, he and Strank in that slot receiver position really are tough to handle.
But I tell you what, you look at this one. Storr had to scramble.
Yep.
Guess who he finds?
Look at Herring in the back of the end zone. Lilly in the front of the end zone.
His second touchdown catch of the night for
and
Bo Lilly.
Here's Schrank with a little square out route, making it look simple.
And the Scots there, you see right there, 21-3 Highland Park up at halftime. It is time for our Highland Park player profile.
Welcome to the 2022 edition of the Highland Park Scots Player Profile. Each week here at halftime, we'll be joined by two or three of the Scots' key contributors to hear their thoughts on the season and that week's upcoming opponent. Tonight, as the Scots conclude the regular season with a trip to visit J.J. Pierce, we're joined by a key member of the Highland Park secondary, as well as a very important member of the Highland Park offensive line. They are cornerback Ethan Burt and offensive guard Will Ogle. Guys, thanks very much for being with us. Well, fellas, you're coming off a very impressive, although rain-soaked, 31-0 victory over Richardson last Friday night. I'm always curious to know on rain delays, in the locker room, are you trying to go over plays in your mind and stay sharp, or what is exactly going on? Because we've had about an hour rain delay before we got started. Ethan, we'll start with you.
We try to stay focused, but, you know, us being boys, we obviously got distracted sometimes, but we were able to come back and get pretty focused.
Right. Are you talking with the coaches about your game plan, about what you're trying to do, or are you just sitting in a room with your headsets, maybe your ear pods on, listening to music, waiting for the lightning to quit? Will, we'll go to you.
So obviously it was senior night, so it was really kind of hectic. You know, we were all in the indoor facility, and we had run our pregame warmups and, you know, our walkthroughs, and then we were actually able to walk out onto the field before the lightning struck. So when, you know, we had our phones turned in, so we didn't really listen to music, but we were kind of, for the first part of the lightning strike, we were still focused, trying to talk over our game plan. And, you know, as I think there was like 3 or 4 lightning strikes. So it was a long time, but, you know, we did a great job coming back after that distraction, and we got the job done. And I think we did a great job coming back from that.
Right. Is it, you know, when you go back out there, Ethan, is it business as usual because you know what you're doing, or do you have to do something to actually get yourself back into playing mode after sitting out an hour?
Well,
go to you.
Well, it's pretty much business as usual. You know, we know what we got to do, start it and to finish the game. So it's just, yes, sir.
Right. Well, you guys did a great job in a rain-soaked game, and I guess it's a good thing that you had it, because it looks like you're going to have another one this week against J.J. Pierce, and so the experience will probably help you. You know, a couple of individual questions. Ethan, we'll start with you. You're in the unique position of being the son of a coach at Highland Park, Chip Burt, the defensive line coach. You don't play directly for him, obviously, since you're in the defensive backfield. But what's that like? I know you love your dad, but what's it like not only having a coach in practice, but also going home with one every night?
Oh, yeah, it's awesome, because middle school, we used to never see each other during football season. So now it's just great. You know, I get extra coaching because he also coached secondary at Duncanville before.
I understand that he's been probably more of a secondary coach in his career than a defensive line coach. That a fair assessment?
Yes, sir, it is.
And so,
Do you get coaching from Coach Smith at practice and then get some more, you know, would y'all look at film together when you go home or?
Yes, sir. During practice, I'll talk to Coach Smith and Coach Eason, and then, which are both great coaches. And then if I have some extra questions to ask, I go to my dad and we'll watch film, help me straighten it out.
Right, right. And I'm sure that, you know, it was a tough decision to decide, you know, we live in Rockfall, but want to come to Highland Park. Was at first, did you resist that and then kind of warm up to it? Or tell me how you felt there.
Well, so my mom actually teaches at Sunnyvale. So I was up there for my freshman year. And I guess it took me about like a month or two to really like figure out where I really wanted to go. And I chose Highland Park.
Yeah. Are you happy with your decision, I guess?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, it's something that we've really enjoyed watching you mature. You guys, one of the things that makes you good on defense in the secondary, like every position, it seems. I know your dad's got about 8 or 9 guys that play defensive line. It seems like you guys have got, you know, 6 or 7 guys that all can interchange in the secondary. How much does that help you guys, you know, being able to interchange parts and if you get winded to come out?
Oh, it's awesome. So we have about, me included, about 3 other great corners that will help on the team when we get hurt or, you know, just need a little break. So we can count on each other.
You've really stood out to us in the booth on your special teams coverage as well. And that's something you obviously take a lot of pride in.
Yes, sir.
I mean, is it something that if you want to do it, or are they asking you to do it, or is it something you go, no, I want to do that?
It's a little bit of both. They ask you, and then if you really want to do it, you're like, yes, sir, put me in.
Right, right. Well, you've really been impressive doing that, as well as what you've done at cornerback, because you really, you know, all you guys come up and force very well. You're obviously not just coverage guys. You're not bashful about stopping the run. Will, we'll move over to you. You are in a unique position being a sophomore with a lot of seniors on the offensive line. Tell us what that transition has been like, going from freshman football to now they're throwing you in there in the heat of the battle, and you're going against guys a couple years older than you. May not be bigger, but still, it's I'm sure low. Tell us about that.
Yes, sir. So last year I was fortunate enough to be on JV Blue.
Okay.
So I was able to work with a lot of the guys that are currently there. Like me and Basso were both on the JV Blue, and you know, it's really great knowing. And I was always at practice with all the guys, you know. And there's some really special seniors we have on our team. They do a great job of, you know, helping me, as well as Case Pickleman, who's another underclassman. And just, it's such a wonderful opportunity to be surrounded by such great guys that really help me and help. They're just great guys.
And the first time that you got thrown out there early in the year, were your eyes big, and were you nervous, and did you talk to somebody next to you who calmed you down?
So I was able to play in the first game, and you know, it's really great. It's a very surreal experience, you know, like not many emotions really go through your head, because you know, you've been working on all, I've been playing football since I was like 7. So you're just so focused on what you've been working up at this point that it kind of just goes all over your head. But it was just a great experience, my first game.
Right, right. Well, it's every sophomore and really every junior who's not played at the varsity level, it's fun to hear their experience, because you obviously get calmer as you go and you get more comfortable. But the first time you roll out there, it's like, my goodness, what am I doing out here? And they're expecting me to block that guy. So.
Yes, sir. It's definitely a new experience.
Right. Well, I always like to hear, you know, you guys' experience with your coaches. Ethan talked about your dad being defensive line coach and helping a little bit in the secondary, but you play specifically for Coach Smith and Coach Eason. Tell me a little bit about how they coach you and how they help you be the best you can be back there in the defensive backfield?
Well, they're very, very, what's it called? Well, I'm going blank right now.
Very, very detail oriented, or?
Oh, yes, sir. They're very detailed, very intense. You know, they love kids, so they're obviously really good coaches.
Yeah. Well, your dad's a pretty intense guy, too. So you probably had experience at that.
Oh, yeah.
That's what makes him a good coach, though. But I'm assuming you, obviously, Coach Smith is your specific coach. But how's he and Coach Eason impacted you and how you play the game?
Oh, they obviously helped me mature a lot coming from a new school.
Yeah.
And not really knowing about all the Highland Park traditions and all that. It really shaped me to where I'm at now.
Right. And you've been in Highland Park now. Is this your third year?
Yes, sir. This is my third year.
Okay. Okay. And Will, we'll move over to you. You play for Coach Wells and Coach Farnsley, two outstanding offensive line coaches. Tell me how they help you day to day get to be the best you can be.
You know, they're really the best in the business. We got Coach Farnsley. He's a wonderful guy. He's hysterical. He's always got something to say. And, you know, you can really tell Coach Farnsley, like, loves you. You can tell from the moment you're playing, even if he yells at you, you can tell he cares very much about you. And I think that's made a lasting impact on me, not just as a football player, but just as a better man. You know, he's really a great guy. And then we got Coach Wells, who's also a great guy. And he's more quiet than Coach Farnsley, but he's very wise. And when he says something, you know, it's exactly what it should be. He's a very wise guy.
Right. Well, it's interesting. Every time I ask an offensive lineman, it doesn't matter what year or how old you are, but the first they start talking about Coach Farnsley, they start to smile. So
yes, sir.
He must do some things that are pretty funny in practice, because everybody I've talked to says, oh, yeah, he can get on you real hard, but then he can joke around a little bit, too.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Definitely.
Suffice it to say, you can't have too thin a skin with him, because he'll toughen you up.
Oh, yeah. He'll find some way to poke at you.
Well, you guys do a tremendous job working with him, and I know you're going to enjoy it more and more as you move along. Well, last question, and this is, you've both been here long enough. I think it's you guys are obviously know this is a special place to play football and to go to school. I mean, Ogle, I'm sure you probably grew up here. Ethan, you found out about it as you've been here the last 3 years. But it's a special community and a special tradition, and that a lot of guys never get a chance to be a part of. A lot of other schools, they're lucky to be 5-5, and you guys are 9-0, getting ready to go in the playoffs and hopefully for a long run. What does it mean to you guys personally to get to be a part of this program and a team like Highland Park in this community? Ethan, we'll start with you. You've been here 3 years, but again, you may have an even better perspective because you've been other places. But what does it mean to be a part of this?
Sir, it's one special place, like you said. I've never experienced something like this before. So my old school, football wise, we were all right. We were about 5-5, like you said. So coming here and going 10-0, hopefully, is a pretty big deal for me. Playing in the playoffs is awesome.
Right. And I'm sure you're very thankful that the opportunity came. We're thankful to have your dad for sure as a coach, because he's a great coach. I know you probably feel thankful that this opportunity arose.
Yes, sir.
And Will, we'll go to you. What I'm assuming you've lived here your whole life. What does it mean to you get to grow up in a community like this and play for a team like the Scots?
Yes, sir. So I did grow up here, and, you know, when you're little, I remember going to the football games when I was little, going to the state championship, the three-peat, you know, and growing up, you know, I really wanted to be a Scot. And I feel like in Highland Park, at a lot of other schools, people want to play college football, people want to play in the NFL, but I feel like in Highland Park, people want to play Scott football.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Like, Scott football is just a huge deal, and it's a big part of our community, and it's just a really cool experience to play for the Scott football. It has so much history, and it's just amazing.
Yeah, and to follow up on that thought, Will, I know David Richards came to talk to you guys, who was inducted into the Ring of Honor, and he's interesting enough. He played college, he played pros, and he said the only part he would like to go back and do again was high school because he had so much fun.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You know, when he spoke to us, he was talking a lot about his high school days, and people like Jack Sides, he still comes to our games, still coaches us a little bit. And you can really tell, like, once you're a Scott, you're always a Scott. You know, it's just a great tradition. And, you know, you'll look at like a bunch of seniors this year. You saw the picture of with their dads. They both have their Letterman jackets on. You know, blue and gold just runs through people here in Highland Park. And it's just such a special thing.
Yep. Well, you're definitely true. Those are great thoughts, and it's great to hear both you guys coming from different backgrounds, if you will, now have met up and become teammates and all pulling for the same thing as we move on down the road. Well, guys, like I said before, it's been tremendously impressive to watch you guys get off to a 9-0 start and how hard you've worked to get to this point. But as I'm sure you know, from this point forward, it's one game at a time, and that's all that matters is that next game and how long you keep playing. We thank you a lot for taking the time to be with us, and we wish you the best of luck against Pierce and on down the road against you, whoever you face in the playoffs as well. Thanks for being with us, Ethan.
Thank you. Thank you.
And Will.
Thank you so much.
Tonight's player profile has been brought to you by Madden Asset Management, global capabilities from the people you trust, and Me for Men. You're watching Highland Park Football, sponsored by the Sewell Automotive Group on the Game On Sports Network.
And again, we're at halftime, 21-3. Highland Park leads, J.J. Pierce, and we're almost ready for the third quarter to get underway. Highland Park out of the locker room, and we will kick off. The Scots will get the ball to start things in the third quarter, so we'll be back right after this.
Conveniently located between Lubbers Lane and University Boulevard on Preston Road. Not Just Soccer is locally owned and has served the Highland Park community for youth sports equipment needs since 1989. Whether you're looking for soccer, football, basketball, baseball, volleyball, or lacrosse equipment, they carry it all, and they take pride with specialists in each sport, and in many circumstances, you'll be helped by a current Highland Park athlete. Go Scots!
Had a service culture, and I don't think anybody is otherwise. Everybody understands that our mission is to take care of families.
And I think what makes me the most proud is how many families and lives we have actually touched. We've been so impactful for so many people, and in different ways of their lives, in ways we couldn't necessarily anticipate.
Well, just about ready to get the third quarter underway. Highland Park with the 21-3 lead, and they get the ball to start the third quarter.
Yeah, and so, again, Coach Allen likes to, as he's talked about many times, seize momentum at the end of the first half by scoring late, which the Scots did, and then if you're lucky enough to get the ball to start the second half, you can really put a stranglehold on a game by going down and scoring a touchdown here.
And the Scots elected to play defense first. They won the opening toss and still got on the board first and jumped out to that 21-3 lead. And again, Highland Park's already won the district, already know who they're going to play next Friday night. They'll play Arlington Bowie at Highlander Stadium. For the Mustangs, though, they are still crossing their fingers that they can get into the playoffs, but they've got to come back. They've got to win this, and then they need some other help tonight as well.
But it beats not having any shot at all if you're J.J. Pierce. And so they're playing hard, trying to find a way, but it's going to be hard to come back on the Scots for this one. But I think everybody is looking forward to next week. It will be interesting to see Warren Peck comes in, gets a little time in the second half at quarterback. Usually what Coach Allen likes to do is likes to run the starters out there the first series maybe and then bring the backups in. But Warren Peck did a fine job last time he was out there in a backup role.
Pat Sauer is in the stands, I believe. We'll go down to him here in just a moment. But he will be catching up with some of the parents. Pat, are you out there?
Maybe at the concession stand.
I was going to say, he went down to the concession stands to find popcorn and coffee, probably. Or hot chocolate.
Obviously, most people know, send our condolences to Pat and our thoughts and prayers. His wife passing away last weekend, and a lot of community people in the community know about this already, but we're so saddened by it, as obviously Pat is, but if you see him, tell him you're thinking about him and praying for him, and he does such a fine job for us in the stands, catching the parents, and we just want him to know how much we love him and how much we appreciate what he does for us.
Beautiful ceremony to remember her yesterday, and again, I just echo the same thoughts that Jim just passed along. Pat, we're thinking about you, and you are in our prayers. So, third quarter, about to get underway. What are you expecting from the Scots here in the third quarter?
I think they're going to go down and score right here. I mean, I think that's what they're told they're expected to do, and they're going to go right down and do it. I've been impressed with, Scots are missing Lawson Petty in the offensive line, and he leaves a big hole, but I've been impressed with Case Pickleman's performance out there at that spot in his absence. And Scots, one of the things we see every year is, once you start the playoffs, injuries start to take a toll, and if you don't have depth, you got a major problem, and the Scots have done a tremendous job this year, I think more than any other, at developing some outstanding depth across the entire field, offense and defense.
Well, you look at the offense, they've got a lot of depth at wide receiver. They've got four different guys who have come in and played running back for them this season, and all four step in there and can fill the shoes. They've got a great backup quarterback in Warren Peck. I think you bring up a great point in the backups they have, and we've talked about it so many times. We talked about it at the top of the broadcast how, they only have a three-man defensive front, but they've got five different guys who can come in there and play.
And really, six or seven or eight when you count Daniel Turner and Cormac Carroll and Carter Noonan. And the backers, the depth with Hunter Thornton and Alex Prowse in the secondary is maybe deeper than I've ever seen it, top to bottom. So Scots are going to need that, and you wish that it wouldn't come up, but it always does. And the more time, the more experience you've gotten those backups, the better they're prepared for jump in there in a big-time game late in the playoffs.
Well, we had a cold front come through the Metroplex, and our temperature now has dipped down to 53 degrees. We're expecting to hover right around 53, 52 throughout the rest of the game. We do have a wind that is blowing out of the north, and that'll stay with us through most of the second half as well. And our weather update brought to you by Peggy Sue's Barbecue. Fine Texas Barbecue since 1951. Now available inside New York Subs.
And Russell, our number one fan, Jenny Scoggins, former director of the Highland Park Alumni Association, is listening to us in New York City. And Jenny, we're glad you're with us. Wouldn't be the same without you.
New York City, is she running the marathon?
I don't know. That's a good question. I think she's there to see her son, but maybe the marathon is in the works as well. There's Coach Allen. You can tell it's gotten quite a bit colder out there. Coach Allen bundled up.
I was going to see if he changed his fedora from the straw hat to the winter. What do you call felt? Thank you very much. See, Yvonne's got to be our producer because I couldn't think of the word felt.
No, he. I can think of several games Coach Allen needed that coat. That's a good one there. He, I don't know if you remember that game out in Mesquite against Everman where it was about 20, 25 degrees and the wind blowing sideways. That was a cold game. Yes.
That was, well, let's go back. As far as this series goes, again, this is the 19th time these two teams have played. Do you remember back, was it 2001 that they played the triple overtime?
Yes. And I remember sitting in the stands. And again, Coach Allen hadn't been in Highland Park too long, but Pierce won that game. We went back and forth, and then Pierce won that game and triple overtime, and I don't think people who live in the Pierce area have still forgotten that game. They bring it up over and over and over again. It's getting a little aged now, be it that it's 20 years ago.
Hey, need to send one more shout out, and this one goes out to Juan Zuniga. Had a little accident at work, and he is laid up, and he's got to be watching the game tonight, no doubt. Juan, we miss you up here in the press box. Hope you're doing better, and just kind of take it easy. Yvonne said he would come back and take care of you and get you whatever you need. Here, high short kick is going to go out of bounds on the far side.
They had three guys lined up
to kick it. Our Davidson Bogle Real Estate Land is Our Business kickoff.
Yeah, I think the wrong guys, Jay pointed out, you couldn't hear him, but the wrong guy kicked the ball. They had Pierce had three kickers out there, and I think the one that the Pierce coaching staff wanted to kick the ball didn't get the signal. And then somebody else kicked it, and you can see three guys throw their hands up. But let's see if the Scots can go down and get one to start the second half.
The Scots will start from their own 20-yard line on first down. Play action, Store to go long, throws it long.
Go.
He's got Luke Herring,
and
caught it.
Here we go.
Herring is off to the races, and Luke Herring is going to take this one the distance. An 80-yard touchdown pass and catch, and Highland Park adds to their total, now up 27-3.
Well, there's no flag on the field. I believe it fell out of his pocket. Officials putting it back in, so it's waved off. But what a throw by Brennan Storr, laying it up. But Herring's got to love those plays where he can just take off and run. And Storr throws it as far as he can. Herring's got to come back to the inside to make the catch. And it looked like Ryan Williams was there to defend for Pierce. But again, Herring swoops in, makes a catch, and sprints to the end zone for the Highland Park touchdown.
That was an 80-yard touchdown throw and run by Highland Park. The longest play I think they've had from scrimmage all season long. Extra point brought to you by Kensington Vanguard National Title, and Jake Tansey is true on that. There's Luke right there.
And if you're a potential playoff opponent for Highland Park, who do you have to cover at receiver? Herring? Yes. Shrank?
Yes.
Lily?
Yes.
Heiss?
Yes.
How do you do that? You know, most teams have two guys maybe that they're going to go to. Highland Park spreads it around so well. Look at that ball drop into Herring's belly right there. And he gets an escort down the field from Jackson Heiss. And a touchdown for the Scots.
Quarter replays this quarter brought to you by Henry S. Miller. The right call for commercial real estate and a proud supporter of Highland Park Scots football, Henry S. Miller.
Well, Luke Herring was due. It's been a while, and this drive recap is going to be quick. As we said, Scots go 80 yards in one play and take 13 seconds off the clock. Touchdown, an 80-yard pass from Storr to Herring. Tansey has the extra point. And 13 seconds into the third quarter, it's Highland Park 28, Pierce 3. This drive recap brought to you by Steward Partners Global Advisory.
Located
in Big D, Dallas, Texas.
Davidson Bogle Real Estate kickoff. Regas puts a foot into it. It's going to be a high kick. It's going to be fielded down there at the 17-yard line. Brought back out to the 25, to the 28-yard line. And on the return is Jack McGarry. And for the Scots, Ethan Burt's down there to make the tackle.
Ethan Burt talked about that at halftime, how he takes a lot of pride in special teams when he's not on the field with the defense.
That was a 12-yard return. By the way, Highland Park now has scored on the opening possession of the second half in every game except the first game. So that's nine consecutive weeks they have scored on their first possession of the third quarter.
That's a tremendous advantage when you can do that.
Here we go on first down, handoff. This is going to be Ryan Williams, and he's going to get hit and driven back. Oh, my goodness, Tommy Rossley is in there to make first contact. And then he got some help from some of his other defensive friends, and they just drove him straight back.
Watch Rossley step up. Ryan Williams, Rossley gets under him, stands him up, and then drives him straight back with the help of Brady Dotrieve. Rossley, again, a tremendous hole filler along with Ramey and Morse.
Presley Harper, quarterback, steps back, throws this one on a rope, but it goes right through the receiver's hand and incomplete. Defending was Charlie Barton. Had to cover a lot of land right there.
Yeah, land is his business too, I think, Charlie. I mean, it's not just Dad. The land is Charlie's business. Here we go.
Third down coming up right here for the Mustangs. Made me giggle a little bit right there. Mustangs 3-for-9 on third down conversions in the first half, and they're going to throw this one long. Quarterback was hit just as he released it, and that's going to come up a little bit short, so it's an incomplete pass. Tommy Rossley got back there, hit the quarterback at the knees, and made that pass come up short, incomplete, in a fourth down situation.
Anytime Harper sprints out left to right, you're going to see Tommy Rossley just make a beeline for him right here. Here he comes. Prowse puts pressure on the quarterback from his outside linebacker position early. Now it's the punt. Here's the punt block Warriors. Let's see if they can go get it. Bunch of seniors in this group.
Be the fourth punt of the night for self, and he almost got to it. And this is going to be the first time that Julian Pham Davis has been able to field one of these, calls for the fair catch, and makes the fair catch.
And that was Jose Suarez making a push to block it. He missed it by an eyelash. And good effort by Jose.
Scots will get the ball back. They'll start at their own 32-yard line now. That was a 37-yard punt, no return. And the Scots bring their offense back out onto the field.
Got Will Ogle now in at left guard for the Scots. Marulis, Basso, Sweeney, and Pickleman still in their spots.
Let's see what Storr and company can do right here. They're going to send three wide receivers to the left side. That's the bottom of your screen. They're going to fake the handoff. Storr is going to run with it himself. Storr started to cut outside, cuts back inside, and he's right at that first down marker. He'll be a little bit short of that, so it's a 9-yard pickup for Brennan Storr.
That's number zero, Ryan Williams, coming up to make that play finally with help from Ethan Hunt. But Storr, a tremendous threat running the ball whenever he takes off. He hadn't had to do it a lot this year, but it's good to know it's in his back pocket.
Came into the game with 382 yards rushing. Has added 22 more yards to that tonight. Storr gets hit just as he released that one. And the ball is batted around, and it is caught. And Jackson Heiss is going to take it in for the touchdown.
Hey,
can
you say volleyball tip? That ball's bouncing up in the air, and Heiss says, "I'll take that. Thank you very much. I got to keep up with my buddy Luke Herring."
Bob Lilly Promotions brings you the touchdown, and it is a beauty right there.
Good protection, big pressure from the outside. Storr unloads it just in the nick of time, and the Pierce defender makes the fatal mistake of popping up in the air where Heiss can still get it, and he does.
59 yards on the pass and catch and run. Jake Tansey with the extra point up and on the way, and it is good. So two big plays through the air for Highland Park to open the third quarter, and they've extended their lead out 35-3 with 9:52 to play. An extra point for Kensington Vanguard national title. We'll take a break. We're back with more third quarter action coming up right after this. We'll be right back.
Seoul is fantastic. You feel you're involved in every step of the decision-making process. That really makes a big difference to me.
Discover our wide variety of new and certified pre-owned vehicles at Seoul Cadillac or SeoulCadillac.com.
Well, third quarter action, two possessions, two touchdowns for Highland Park. And there you get a look at number three. He caught the touchdown pass a moment ago. And there you look just to his left is 44, Bo Lilly. And here's another look at that touchdown throw just a moment ago.
Store does a good job hanging in there when he's getting hit. And great concentration, Jackson Heiss, to keep his focus on the ball and bring it in.
We'll take it down to Pat Sauer here momentarily.
Here's the drive recap, Russell, for that Highland Park scoring drive. The Scots go 68 yards in two plays, take 52 seconds off the clock, excuse me. The touchdown, the 59-yard pass from Brennan Storer to Jackson Heiss. Tansy adds the extra point, and with 9:52 to go in the third quarter, Highland Park 35 and Pierce 3. This drive recap brought to you by Stewart Partners Global Advisory, located right here in Dallas.
Here's the kickoff, and this is going to be taken and brought right back up the left seam, and Jack McGarry is going to take this one the distance. He's going to return it for a touchdown. Wow. He found a crease in the Highland Park coverage team and goes 81 yards for the touchdown. Well, first touchdown the Scots have given up in two games.
Yep. Good, nice return. Scott's trying to shimmy down, trying to squeeze the play, but a couple of good blocks and a good fake by McGarry allows Pierce.
Extra point to come right here. They've got it teed up and, well, almost had a bad snap right there. Nice job done by the holder. That was Noah Self. And the kick is good. It was Shaddle.
Result of the play, the successful extra point.
Let's take another look at the touchdown. Well, the receiver, I mean the returner, boy, turns on the Jets.
Yeah, he's
and then
got
he got a nice block just as he was getting into the clearing.
He's got some speed, McGarry does.
35-10. Highland Park still, though, with the commanding lead. And Pat Sauer, I believe, has a special guest up in the stands. And let's go down to Pat. Sideline reports tonight and our fan cam brought to you by Willow Bend Mortgage, your home for a way better mortgage. Pat, are you ready to go?
I'm ready to go. I've got Michelle Peck. I'm trying to get the cameraman's attention. I had it about 10 seconds ago. But anyway, I've got Michelle Peck. This is Warren Peck's mom. And, you know, these Highland Park kids, they support each other. And to talk a little bit about the great season that Storer's having and about waiting your turn here at Highland Park with all his friends and et cetera.
Boy, that boy is amazing to watch. Storer's had some beautiful touchdown passes, and he can scramble just gorgeous out there on the field.
In a time when people transfer, lots of kids transfer in high school if they're not getting to play, and then college, they're moving all over the place. What's the reason he stuck around and waited his turn?
Well, Coach Allen. I mean, you can't get a better coach than Coach Allen, and he has learned so much being a Scot and being a Scot all the way from kindergarten on. You can't beat that kind of team players and wonderful and friends on the team and wonderful coaches. You can't beat that.
Well, we look forward to seeing him against some more tonight and next season. Thank you, Michelle.
I like those earrings, Michelle, too. They tried the onside kick, didn't get it. Jack Morris was there to cover it for Highland Park. Did a nice job of jumping on that football and not letting it go.
Yeah, and Highland Park expecting the onside kick, and Jack Morris, a good guy to have over there to field it. All right, looks like Warren, let's see. No, this is Storer still.
Colin Hale is in at wide receiver to the bottom of your screen. There's
Yeah.
a handoff
Hello.
On a delay,
Hello.
And Wilson Axley has a seam. Axley's got 15 yards and a first down for the Scots.
Boy, how explosive is Wilson Axley? Watch this draw. He gets the ball, and he is through the hole before Pierce can turn around. And if not for a tackle right there at the end by Ryan Williams, number zero, Axley might have gone the distance.
Highland Park gets a first down at the 30-yard line after Axley's first run of the second half. That was a 16-yard run. Here's the play action, and Storr is going to keep it. Boy, things opened up for him. Now he's going to backtrack just a little bit. Headed for the boundary, right side, 15, 10, 5. He'll step out of bounds before he can get to the end zone. They're going to call him out at the 10, I believe.
Well, Storr
that's still going to be another first down.
Yeah, and Storr was looking to throw to his left, had good protection, but then the route wasn't there. He's looking for it, so he says he gets a good seal down block by Case Pickleman, takes off to the left, bolts back to the right, and I thought he was going to score, but he's out inside the 10. All right, excuse me, right at the 10.
Quarter replays brought to you by Henry S. Miller, the premier full-service commercial real estate company in Texas and a proud supporter of the Scots. That's Henry S. Miller. Highland Park back into the Shelby American red zone at the 10-yard line with a first down. Storr looks right. Lofts this one into the end zone. Back shoulder throw, and
oh,
it
nice
is caught,
catch.
But it's out of bounds. Jackson Heiss.
Heiss did a nice job trying to tiptoe on the sideline, keep his feet in. You'll see if we get the replay. He's very talented in how he's very adept at how he tiptoes on the side. Watch his feet. Almost.
Another 6 inches of sideline right there, and that's
right.
Another touchdown for the Scots.
Been able to do that and keep the concentration on the ball, even though he's going to hit the ground.
Second and goal to go. Getting the ball spotted to the right hash. This time, Axley. It's not going to get back to the line of scrimmage.
That's number nine coming in. Make the play, Jonathan Agamudu.
Say that one more time.
Jonathan Agamudu, I think is how you say it.
Third down and goal to go for the Scots.
I wondered why you hadn't been saying number nine when he makes it.
I was just waiting to see if you could
see if I could get it out.
Third down. This time, Storr looks to his left. Things open up, and Storr is going to take this one towards the corner of the end zone and literally walk into the end zone for a 10-yard touchdown run. Brennan Storr gets the touchdown right there, his fifth rushing touchdown this season.
And here you see it. He's looking hard over there to Luke Herring, wants to throw it, pumps it, but then the Red Sea parts. Storr says, I can get to the end zone easily, and he does, going to the pylon for 6 points.
Our Kensington Vanguard National Title Company extra point coming up right here. Jake Tansey. It's good. Scots now lead it 42-10 after the extra point goes through, and we've got 7:49 to play here in the third quarter. And wouldn't be surprised if we start seeing some of those second teamers make their appearance in the game for Highland Park. Again, Highland Park scores, now leading it 42-10 as we take this timeout.
Determination on the field breeds determination in life. Discipline needed on the court will be the same discipline that gets the job done. That's why Tailwater Capital is a proud supporter of the Highland Park Athletic Program, the winningest athletic program in the state of Texas. 11 Lone Star Cups, 112 state championships, and a commitment to excellence that serves its players for a lifetime. From the locker room to the boardroom, Scots find a way.
Let's take a look at that drive recap.
Yeah, Russell, I was mentioning to you off the air, the drives for Highland Park in the second half, one play, touchdown, two plays, touchdown. This one, five plays and a touchdown. Scots are getting it done quickly. So they go 46 yards in five plays, take a minute 48 off the clock, touchdown, a 10-yard scamper by Brennan Storr. Tansey has the extra point, and with 7:49 to go in the third quarter, it's Highland Park 42 and Pierce 10. This brought to you by Steward Partners Global Advisory.
Nicholas Regas on the kickoff for Highland Park. That's going to be Caden Varner who returns it out to the 20 or so. And let's take another look at that touchdown just a moment ago. Our replay is brought to you by Henry S. Miller.
And his receivers, Bo Lilly and Jackson Hyes, getting in appropriate position to screen defenders off so Store can walk into the end zone.
Telling the stories about the touchdown. Yeah. I saw it. It just opened up right there. Yeah. And
when they're 45 years old, they'll still be telling that story.
He's telling Jackson Heiss and Bo Lilly right there, thank you for your blocks. Direct snap coming back there to the running back. McGarry's trying to get around the left side. He won't get there. And for the Scots, that's going to be Kyle Carlson who comes in and makes the tackle.
Spencer Brown, Lewis Montgomery, Carlson in at the defensive front.
Second down and 9, so they did give him 1 yard on that.
Unbalanced right again. Here comes the power.
Quarterback's going to keep it himself, coming near side. Gets across the 25, lowered his head, and then gets shoved back. In on the tackle for the Scots, Carl Williams. That's also in there was Alex Prowse.
Robert Ramey in there as well. Ramey and Rossley in at linebackers. Thornton and Barton in at the outside linebackers.
Quarterback is Presley Harper, 5'10 sophomore, 175-pounder. Play action. The sophomore wants to throw into the flat left side. Got it to his running back, Williams. He made the catch and then gets taken down by Charlie Barton over on the far side.
Barton,
nice job by Charlie.
Barton, super solid. Highland Park's had two of the best outside backers they've had in a long time with White and Barton, and Hunter Thornton's not far behind in that group. Look at Kyle Carlson get up, almost blocked that pass. Was that Carlson? I think it was.
I believe it was.
Oh, the ball's on the ground
for a moment. Highland Park swarms it. Mustangs will get back on top of it. That is Noah Self, who covered the football.
Ethan Bird in. Help make the play from his cornerback position. May have been Lewis Montgomery with his hands up that time because Carlson was downfield pursuing. Oh, man, the whole offensive line shifts.
Noah Self is in at quarterback now for
the Mustangs.
Self will run it around the right side. They don't even list him as a quarterback. John Giesen is their backup quarterback, but again, Self is in there playing quarterback now, number 12 for the Mustangs.
Just a wildcat, and Hunter Thornton plays it perfectly. Doesn't come up with the tackle due to a great move by Noah Self, but Hunter Thornton does a very nice job coming up and forcing on that play.
Mustangs are 4-for-11 on third down. This is third and long. This time the quarterback is back in there, and Harper will throw. That's going to be incomplete. Intended for Varner over on the far side. And defending on the play is Carl Williams for the Scots. There's number 30 right there.
Good coverage by Carl. Done a tremendous job this year.
Take another look at it right here. That's that kind of that hard throw to make. Running to the left.
Yep.
Right-handed quarterback.
Scott's with the punt block team of seniors. This is the Berserkers.
Let's see if they can get to it. Self is going to punt this one away. They almost got to it. It's going to be Julian Pham Davis.
I believe that may be Steele Tobin.
Nope, you're right. You're right. Steele Tobin on the return for Highland Park. His first time in there to return punts this evening.
Has Steele been holding on extra points? I have noticed. Here's a look at the Scots almost be blocked that get that block, but Tobin been holding on extra points and gets a chance to return a punt. He has got some major quicks. If he gets in the open field just like Jay Cox, he's liable to be gone. All right.
Here we go. Scots will take over at their own 35. Ball spotted middle of the football field. Here's the throw, and Grayson Schrank off the play action. Store does a great job of throwing the bullet down to the 45-yard line, and the defensive backs, the two safeties, come in to make the stop. Ryan Williams and Evan Grimsley. But a great catch right there by
Schrank. That's hard to cover unless you got some very athletic outside linebackers. But Schrank's going to win that battle 99 times out of 100.
That's a 20-yard pickup, says Mike McAbee. And Highland Park's got another first down. Here's a play action.
Here we go.
Throw across the middle again, and this is going to be caught. This time for the Scots, getting in there to make the catch is Colin Sewell, his first catch of the night.
And yep. And Jay Ellis pointed out that Brennan Storr, you can watch him right here. Watch him wait till the receiver gets open. He sees Sewell. Looks like he might have wanted to go outside to Heist, but then pulls it back and goes on the slant right to Sewell, and it's a Highland Park first down.
13-yard pass play right there. Scott's keep it in the air, and again, this time the throw off to the right side, and that's going to be caught, and they'll push it forward for a first down, and a great run after catch. Colin Hale came up with the catch there for Highland Park and did a tremendous job to get the first down.
You know, that's a play that the Scots have run in past years a lot. One of the receivers gets out in front, blocks, and then it's the pitch route to Sewell behind it. And Coach Allen hadn't run it, to Hale. Coach Allen hadn't run it as much this year, but it's still a great play.
That was Sewell who was in front of him and helping block to make room for him to pick up the first down right at the 20-yard line. Storr now has 374 passing yards tonight.
Nice.
Here's the option play. The pitch goes out right side to Frank Musa. He's upended. Once he gets inside the 15, they'll knock him down at the 14-yard line and in to make the tackle right there. Inside linebacker Alexis Gomez.
And Storr getting better and better running the option. He runs out there to the pitch man and gives him a little juke, makes him wonder whether he's going to keep and turn up or pitch, then dishes it to Musa, allows Musa to get out for a nice gain.
6-yard pickup right there leaves Highland Park facing second down and 4. Once they get to the 10, they'll have a first down. They'll try it right here. They're inside the Shelby American red zone. The pass into the end zone.
Hello.
Caught, touchdown. That's Colin Hale, who comes up with the touchdown catch, his first of the season.
A nice route by Hale. Just goes up and heads to the outside. And the corner froze. And Hale gets to the outside in the end zone, and it's a touchdown for the Scots.
Brought to you by Bob Lilly Promotions, proudly supporting the Highland Park Scots since 1999.
What an inside, beautiful inside cut, and then back to the outside by Hale. As Coach Allen said many times, he got a lot of great wide receivers. You may not see them all, but that doesn't mean they're not just as talented, and you saw it right there with Colin Hale.
Jake Tansey with the point after, and Highland Park's lead now out 49-10 with 2:18 to play in the third quarter as we take this timeout. Scots have a big lead, and we'll be back in just a moment.
With almost 100 offices across the state of Texas and 50 of them in the DFW area alone, Capital Title is here to serve you. Made by Texans, for Texans. Capital Title is the largest independent title company in the United States. We are Dallas-born, Dallas-based, and family-owned. We support the Highland Park Scots.
Colin Hale with his first touchdown catch of the season right there. And you get an up-close look at Colin coming down with the catch.
And gets celebration, leap, Basso with him punching him in the air. That scoring drive for the Scots. They go 65 yards again in 5 plays. Take 2:40 off the clock. Touchdown, 14-yard pass from Brennan Storr to Colin Hale. Tansey adds the extra point. Storr is 16 for 23. For 388 yards, and Highland Park leads 49-10 with 2:18 to go in the third quarter.
Blake Follett with the return right there, and he had no place to go. It was Caden Varner from the 3-yard line, brought it out to the 15.
And Nathan Harper coming in to make the play. Harper been hurt a lot of the year, but now back healthy when the Scots need him most. Up front, we got Daniel Turner at a defensive end, Blake Andrews at nose, and Carter Noonan at the other defensive end.
Well, the ball is batted up in the air and knocked away for Highland Park. That's Hunter Thornton who got his hands up there and deflected the pass.
It's Hunter Thornton showing his athletic ability. Here he comes on the blitz. If you can't get there, get up in the air. And he's a hair away from having that ball picked off by one of his teammates.
Harper again, this time out of the
reverse.
Well, they're going to run a reverse off of it back to Caden Varner, and he's not going to get back to the line of scrimmage. The Highland Park defense smells that out, and Jack Morris gets back there to make the tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
Jack Morris sniffed that out before anybody knew what was coming. Watch Morris. He sees it. He gets back there, and he's 8 yards deep in the backfield waiting for him, saying, come on, baby. Come on. I'm right here waiting on you.
It's going to be a 5-yard loss on the play. Brings up third and 15.
So the Scots can put pressure on.
Harper turns, looks to the sideline. Now they're going to move one of the receivers from left to right. Here's a pass into the flat right side. It's going to go over the receiver's head, and that's going to be an incomplete pass intended there for Andrew Casagrande.
Casagrande's played a big role in previous Pierce games.
Mike McAbee tells me Casagrande is a place in Arizona. Never been there. Been to Arizona, but...
All right, here we go with the punt block, the Berserkers or the Warriors. Here we go. Oh!
They almost got to it. Noah South kicks it away. The ball is going to bounce on the ground. It's going to be picked up.
Tobin.
Highland Park territory and... brought out to the 48-yard line.
Good job by Steele Tobin, fielding that, not letting it roll.
I believe we've got a special guest down on the sideline with Jay Ellis. Our sideline reports for Willow Bend Mortgage, your home for a way better mortgage. Jay, take it away.
Yeah, many Scots fans may or may not recognize this guy. Everything about him looks like Jack Curtis except for the hair. This is Highland Park's defensive player of the year for last year's district, Jack Curtis, who's now playing at Air Force. Jack, first of all, what's it like to be here on the sideline instead of on the field watching the Scots?
It's definitely a little weird, but it's great to see the guys, you know, that I saw last year get a lot of playing time, and, you know, some of the younger guys, too, contributing, and just seeing how the new team forms, because every year is different, and, you know, you see how this team has come together and obviously had a great season thus far, looking to be on the way to an undefeated regular season and on to the playoffs, so I'm excited to see what they can do come playoff season. It's just good to see how they've come together as a team and, you know, how it's so different, but still the same guys from last year.
Hey, Jack, how did Highland Park prepare you for the Air Force Academy?
Yeah, just, you know, doing the little details right, doing excellence in all that we can do is, you know, really translated well for me. And that, you know, just doing the best I can at everything, you know, that's something that Highland Park taught me, and that, you know, I feel like it's translated really well into the college life of college football. And I think it'll benefit me in the future as I, you know, continue my college career.
Hey, Jack, I hope you'll get a chance to see some of these guys after the game. Have you had a chance to talk to some of your former teammates who are still playing?
I've got to talk to some of them, yeah. I definitely catch up with them after the game. You know, I know I've been away for a while, but it's definitely great to see some of the guys, you know, see some of them contributing a lot, you know, some of the, mainly the seniors and some of the juniors as well, just seeing them develop from the time I was on the team to now, just been a huge change, something that it's really cool to see, you know, come down the road and seeing how far they can develop even in the next week, because, you know, every week you get better, and that's something that we do here, and that's, you know, something that's not going to change now that I've left.
Hey, Jack Curtis is a great example of why Highland Park football is so successful. We're glad to have you back, and thank you for talking with us tonight.
Yes, sir. It's great to be back. Go Scots.
Go Scots. That's right.
All right. Thank you very much. And again, our sideline reports for Willow Bend Mortgage, your home for a way better mortgage. Warren Peck has come in at quarterback for Highland Park, and number 12 going down, sacked right there by the defense. And that's going to bring us to the end of the third quarter. And we're going to take a break. As we go to the fourth quarter, I'll remind you our score, Highland Park 49, J.J. Pierce 10. We're back in just a moment.
It's the Baker Brothers replay. Team Baker Brothers scored a big one with this touchdown tune-up.
That unit sure has some cool moves.
I'll admit it, Jimmy. That's one super shuffle.
Free smart home thermostat with a new Linux AC system.
We see you, early riser, paying the price
making your move. We see you because we are you. Entrepreneurs Banking Entrepreneurs. As one of the few Texas banks participating in the Main Street Lending Program, Vista Bank is helping small businesses put America back to work. Isn't it time you join the over 1,500 new PPP clients and make your move to a bank that hustles as hard as you do? Vista Bank. People first.
Well, we're ready to get the fourth quarter underway, and Highland Park has the ball, and they've moved it down to the 34-yard line. Warren Peck in at quarterback. They'll throw the screen pass right side. This is Musa who made the catch, and Musa is going to fall over on the sideline. He kind of got tangled up with the defensive player right there, and Musa's got 8 yards on the screen pass.
Yeah, Musa kind of got bumped after he was out of bounds right there. Max Sloan, number 19, is right there going, hey, shouldn't that be a penalty?
I believe Pat Sauer has an interview, and let's take it up to the stands. And this is brought to you by Willow Bend Mortgage. Pat, go ahead.
I got Chris Hale here, Colin Hale's dad. Crowd favorite over here. talk about that last catch over there for the touchdown.
We were really excited. In fact, as he went down the field, we thought, is he going to get in bounds? And he reached, pulled down a huge Brennan throw. We were really happy for him, but it was his great blocking that got out in front of him, and a lot of work over the season. You know, we've got a wonderful season going on with the fact that I think we set a new record for undefeated seasons this week as well.
Well, he's a great player. We've got some depth out here. And I was just really good to see him get in the end zone.
Well, I appreciate that, and it's a good time to end the season with a great catch, so appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Pat. Wagner Perry getting his first carry of the night, and now the handoff is going to be made to Perry again, and he's going to get knocked down behind the line of scrimmage. Christian Baker first to get to him, and the ball goes over on downs after Highland Park does not pick up the first down. .10:29 to play in the football game. Highland Park up 49-10. Scots will finish off as we heard just a moment ago with another 10-win season. And the stat that we bring up all the time is talking about Coach Allen since he's been here. This will be his 280th win. He averages better than 10 wins a season.
And you know how incredible that is.
Here we go. Noah Self carries it around the left side, and he gets decked right at the 25-yard line. Tommy Rossley came in there. First contact made, though, for Highland Park by Ethan Burke.
And also coming in to make a hit there, again, Nathan Harper, we spoke about just a minute ago, Nathan in at safety. But getting back to the 10-win season, we take it for granted, and we just don't appreciate it as much as we should, that he has averaged 10 wins a year for over 20 years. Now think about that. 20 year over. Coach Allen's been here 24 years.
Number 50. 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
And even if you've got great teams, that is so incredible to do. You know, even with it, great teams will lose a game every now and then here and there. And Coach Allen, all I can say is there's nobody else I'd rather have as a head coach here at Highland Park.
Mustangs, second down and 12. This time, Harper to throw into the flat. That's going to be caught. Coming up with the reception on the far side is Jake Lehman. Defending on the play right there, was that White or was that the corner?
That was that Ballard? It was Ballard out there, number 34. Mac Ballard. Ethan Bird in at the other corner, opposite Ballard. We've got Sam Webster and Rossley in at the backers. Preston Bond and Harper, Nathan Harper into the safety. Here comes the shift. Got a trick play coming.
They're going to go into swinging gate looking play right here.
Yep.
They want a double pass. That was a lateral pass, and the throw downfield is going to be caught. This is going to go for a big first down. The pass was eventually caught down at the Highland Park 40-yard line. Noah Self threw it. Blake Follett caught it, and they'll move the chains.
Scott's adjusted well to it, but I think that the key was the ball may have bounced out there when it was thrown out to the left, and because it was a lateral, let's see here.
No, it didn't bounce,
I don't think.
I'm not going to get a look at it, but it's going to be a penalty, and this is going to go against the offense. Let's take a look at this Origin Bank replay right here. There you see they spread everything out.
Harper back in at quarterback. Oh, he almost dropped it. But again, if it's a lateral, which it had to be if he's going to throw again, he can drop it and pick it up and still throw it.
Origin Bank, every great relationship has an origin story. They bring you the replays here in the fourth quarter. First down and 15 after the penalty. Play action. They'll throw a little look in from the right side. That's going to be incomplete. Intended out there on the far side for Varner.
Presley has struggled a little bit on the deeper routes tonight. Presley Harper, I should say, the Pierce quarterback. But you can tell he's a sophomore. He's going to be a good one when he gains experience.
We'll take a look at all the numbers coming up during the postgame show tonight. That's part of our game summary stats report brought to you by Park City's YMCA. We've got a timeout that's going to be taken right here and called by the Mustangs.
Yep.
That's going to be their first of the second half. Let's go back down to Jay Ellis along the sideline. Jay, you've been doing a great job. Has Owen been helping you down there?
He has a lot. In fact, he just identified. We saw a scout over here that I thought was just any old scout, but Owen called it right. It was the head coach of Denton Guyer here to watch the scouts tonight. So apparently they're looking toward week 12 the same way that Highland Park is.
How surprising that Guyer would be here to watch Highland Park.
Right. He was talking to his former boss, who of course now is the head coach or the athletic director for Highland Park. That's Coach Rodney Webb.
Tell Owen he doesn't have to run out of the picture when they put y'all on camera.
Next time he'll be with me.
I'll tell you what, we give Owen a hard time, but we love that kid.
He's great. He's going to be a good one.
Back to action now, second down and 15 coming up for the Mustangs.
Highland Park's,
yeah, they've got four people up on that defensive line. Pass left side, that's caught. And it's going to go for a first down. That's Jack McGarry who made the catch. Came into the game with 340 yards in receptions, just a junior. They have a relatively young team, the Mustangs do.
Yeah, I counted, Russell. There's 64 kids on the team, only 19 are seniors. So that's three quarters of the team are younger than seniors.
And again, the quarterback, just a sophomore. McGarry, the junior slot receiver, number 5, has 38 yards in receptions tonight.
Ryan Williams, a running back and two-way starter on defense as well. He's a junior.
A handoff and no place to go. Welcome Daniel Turner.
I believe that was Daniel Turner, number 54, who Ethan Coach Burt has said he's going to do great things. Well, number one, they got to try to block him. Daniel Turner says, if you're not going to block me, I'm going to make the play, and here I come.
Third down. 5 for 14 on third downs tonight. The Mustangs are.
Alex Prowse in for the Scots outside backer.
Here you go. Option play goes off to the right side. The quarterback pitched it, and the running back is going to be taken down. Thrown down by Alex Prowse on the far side. Big number 90 coming in there to make the play for the Highland Park defense.
Look at Prowse. Plays the quarterback, forces him to pitch, and still makes the play on the pitchback, which theoretically you're not supposed to be able to do, but Alex Prowse just did it.
Great play right there by Prowse. Fourth down coming up now for the Mustangs. They will go for it right now. With just 6 minutes to go, they trail by 39.
Andrews.
They're 1 for 2 on fourth down conversions tonight. Presley rolls to the left, stops, throws downfield, and it's going to be picked off. Intercepted inside the 10-yard
line. Preston Bond.
Bond will bring it out to the 20, 25, 30. Still on his feet. He's going to get upended at the 35-yard line. Preston Bond gets the interception, his first of the season, and the turnover brought to you by Dr. Heinrich of Hilltop Orthopedics and Sports Medicine.
And if not for quarterback Presley Harper, for J.J. Pierce, Preston Bond might have been gone. Tremendous open field running. There you see Presley rolling hard to his left, laying it up, and Bond picking it off. Now watch his run. Picks up some good blocks, goes inside, goes outside, and that's the quarterback making the play and getting his helmet knocked off.
29 yards on the return right there. And we will hear from his dad coming up here in just a moment. Boy, he's getting all the attaboys from his teammates, too.
That's great.
And again, we've got Warren Peck in at quarterback for the Scots. He'll turn and hand off and over right guard. About 5 yards on the pickup right there. Wagner Perry on his third carry of the night. By the way, we got some work to do. Not only do we have to pick players of the game, but we've got to get our play of the game brought to you by Riddell Plumbing, home of honest quality, great customer service, and a proud supporter of the Scots. Our play of the game tonight, I thought it was going to be Bo Lilly on that long touchdown catch. Then I thought it was going to be Grayson Schrank. Yep. Then I thought it was going to be Luke Herring. It might be that interception.
Might be that interception.
Might be this run by Brian Rapp.
By Brian Rapp getting to the outside. Nice little run right there by Mr. Rapp. Hey, and I thought it was going to be Lilly on that scramble out route that Storr found him in the corner of the end zone.
Here we go. Look at Rapp. He started left, then cuts back to his right.
Hey,
how about that stiff arm?
I love the stiff arm. Put it right in his face. No face mask. Just hold the defender off.
23 yards on the run. That was Evan Grimsley who came in to make the tackle for the Mustangs.
Sloan and Colin Patrick in at wideouts.
They've got it down to the 37-yard line. Here's a pass play right side. That's going to be thrown and caught. And
Colin
that
Patrick.
Is Colin Patrick on his first catch of the night.
Slot.
Let's take it down to, to the stands across the way. Pat Sauer has a special guest, and this is brought to you by Willow Bend Mortgage.
Okay, I got Bo Bond here. You remember his son was a running back a couple of years ago, and that was Preston Bond that intercepted that ball, and I thought he was taking it to the house.
I think he ran 150 yards to get 20, but it was a lot of fun watching him with the ball.
Yeah, he looks really quick, and then all of a sudden, he got upended.
Yeah, I'll tell you, he's having a great time out there. What a great tradition with the Scots. I've got two boys out there on varsity. I've had a third one as a freshman, so I'm just lucky to be here and watching all my kids play.
Well, exciting to watch him. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Take care.
Marshall Miller on his first reception for Highland Park sets the Scots up with a first down at the 21-yard line, and I believe that is Marshall's first catch of the season. And
Cannon Canipa in at the slot receiver to the left.
Here we go. Warren Peck in at quarterback out of the gun. Turns and hands it off. Not a lot of running room for Brian Rapp this time. He's going to get taken down right about the line of scrimmage. Coming in to make the tackle for Mustangs.
To Benjamin Hobart. Makes the tackle.
Inside 3 minutes to go for this one.
Whit Thompson in at left tackle for the Scots. Pickleman in at center. Paul Flowers in at right guard. Ogle and Nussbaum.
Throw across the middle, incomplete. There was really good defense being played right there.
That's intended for number 89.
Cannon Canipa. Get another look at it right here.
Maybe a little behind him, but
third down. Peck looks left, comes back right, wants to throw. Will throw it into the end zone. That's going to be over the head of the intended receiver. He had to just throw that one away. as double coverage down there. Max Sloan, the intended receiver. Colin Patrick, the intended receiver.
No, bring up fourth
down.
Wait
a minute. It was Sloan. I'm sorry. I'll get this right in a minute. Maybe. First day on the job. 2:07 to go in the football game.
We're trying to train you.
Fourth down. Let's see what happens here on fourth down. Boy, get out of the way. Run. Peck throws. Fires this one downfield. He had a pocket that was collapsing all around him and had to get rid of it.
You know, you and I both know why you're laughing at that, because you saved my rear end for a lot of years.
Owen's down there going, keep messing up.
Yeah,
keep messing
right.
up. Ball goes over on downs, and the Mustangs get it back with 1:54 to play. Got to come up with our players of the game. Our post-game show tonight, as always, brought to you by Burger House, official burger of Highland Park football, the Burger House. Here we go on first down. Play action, throw across the middle. It's going to be an incomplete pass. In at quarterback now for the Mustangs is John Gesson. That's their senior quarterback. He's only completed 7 of 16 passes for 52 yards this year. And that's going to be another incomplete pass.
Down to 1:47 in the game.
There you go. You get a look at some of the Highland Park fans that are here braving the cold weather. Pass comes near side. That's going to be incomplete. It was intended there for Matthew Boerig, and it is incomplete. It's going to stop the clock with 1:36 to go. We'll also get highlights of tonight's game during our Burger House post-game show, so we'll hear from head coach Randy Allen, too.
In at nose guard for the Scots, number 60, Matthias Zacharias. Number 56, Noah Lilly.
Straight drop back.
Oh!
Now in trouble, he's going to go down. There's a sack right there. Alex Prowse is in there.
With help from number 74, that is Ryan Yates.
That quarterback sack brought to you by Advantage Healthcare Systems. They're here to help traumatically injured individuals, whether on the job or in a significant accident.
Prowse and Yates met at the quarterback.
Advantage.
Make a big play. Prowse showing his abilities here several times this game.
There's big number 90 right there. You're looking at him, 6 foot, 190-pound senior. 195-pound senior.
It looks like his reach is incredible. It looks like he's got long arms, which is great for a defensive lineman.
Mustangs are going to take a timeout right here. And we're going to hold it right here through the break. Well, the Scots will play next week. It'll be a Friday night game back at Highlander Stadium. We're expecting a big crowd for that one as they will take on Bowie out of Arlington High School. And it'll be a 7 o'clock kickoff for the first round of the playoffs. And the Scots on their way to another undefeated regular season.
And with a little luck, we'll start on time at 7 p.m.
Good news about tonight's game. There have been nobody injured. Our injury updates every week are brought to you by Dr. Field Scoville at the Carroll Clinic. Orthopedic surgeon, fellowship trained in sports medicine. They do good work over at the Carroll Clinic. And Dr. Field Scoville, we thank you for being a supporter of Highland Park football. And we are glad that nobody got hurt tonight, so we didn't really have to go into that real deeply.
All right, here's the senior punt block team, the Warriors.
Noah Self is going to kick this one away. He just did get a foot into it. It's going to take a Mustang bounce out across the 50 and be down at about the 47-yard line. So the Scots will get it back with 30 seconds to go, and I wouldn't be surprised if they down it and just let this clock roll down to zero. So the Scots will finish up at 10-0 on the season.
And when Highland Park back in February got put into 6A, how many people would have said they're going to end up 10-0?
Pat Sauer and Jay Ellis, about the only two people that I think said that but, Highland Park was going to be 10. We didn't do it. We didn't do our...
They bet on horse races knowing who won already.
Well, that's
so
true.
There you go.
Hold on. Bring Pat's microphone up because he's got something to say here. Last time what?
Well, last time we were in 6A was, what, 2015 season? And we only lost one game, and it was to that Pulaski Academy in Arkansas. So, hey, the Scotties can play.
Oh, they can.
That was that weird team that never punted and always onside kicked.
Yep. They went for it every fourth down except one time, I believe.
Yeah, we made them punt. That was their only punt in, like, I don't know how many years in that game. We made them punt.
23rd undefeated season in Highland Park history.
Thank you to Jason Petty for that little note. We weren't quite sure how many, but 23 times the Scots have gone 10-0.
Looking at that guy right there, he has now a record of 434-92-6. Here at Highland Park, Randy Allen now 280 victories and only 32 losses. And Highland Park finishes the regular season at 10-0.
And now, we can say it, the real season starts.
Exactly. Pierce closes out their season 4-6. They had to win tonight to have a shot at the playoffs. Obviously, they don't, so they are finished up for the season under the first year of direction of head coach Jarrett Lambert, who got the job in June, very late after the head coach left. And he takes him to a 4-6 first season, his first year ever to be a head coach, as a matter of fact.
All right. So got off to a tough start. I think you said first four games they lost and then picked up three wins in a row. And so hopefully for Coach Jarrett's sake, they can start to turn the corner.
We'll hear from head coach Randy Allen coming up as our Burger House postgame show gets underway. I believe we're going to have Coach Allen coming up here in just a moment. Jay, you just let us know. He's talking to his wife right now.
Jay, do not interrupt.
Family does come first, and let's again.
This is why Jay's a good sideline reporter, because he's got about a 10-yard cushion. He's doing a good job of staying back and letting Coach celebrate a little bit.
Knows when to talk to Coach and when not to talk to Coach.
He's like a cat in the jungle. He's starting to sneak up on him.
Okay, I believe Coach is coming over there to visit with Pete Delkus.
You know, you might want to interview Carolyn Allen, too, while she's there.
Okay, looks like as soon as they finish this, are you ready, Coach? I've got Coach Allen if we're ready.
Yeah, yep, go ahead, Pete.
Pete Delkus, right. Hey, Coach Allen, congratulations on a 10-0 season. This is the 23rd time in 100 years that Highland Park has had an undefeated season. First, just put it in perspective and tell us about the players you've had that were able to do that.
Well, I can't remember. I've had so many good teams that have had 10 wins, but I saw on the board where this is the 43rd 10-win season. I don't know if that means 10-0 or whatever, but this team is, I'm really proud of them. We're starting to play really good defense. We're scoring with big plays, and so I'm really proud of them. They beat some good football teams to get here, and we're going to put a bow on this one and celebrate tonight and then get ready for the playoffs next week.
Coach Allen, Highland Park has always been effective at throwing the ball to lots of receivers. But tonight, Brennan Storr threw six touchdown passes to five different wide receivers, including all four starters. Talk about how important it's been for this offense to have so many weapons for him to throw the ball to.
Well, we have a great receiving core, and Brennan did a really good job of distributing the ball, finding an open receiver. And, you know, we got some guys that could go all the way with it. We got track speed out there. And I was sure happy to get Colin Hill a touchdown there on that post corner. It was a great route, a good throw. And then Heiss made a great catch. Luke made some big plays with a vertical route. And then, of course, Grayson made a big play on he caught a touchdown, too. So Bo had a great catch early in the game on a vertical route. So we've got five good receivers, and they really showed off tonight and showed what they could do.
Defensively, you guys have been great as well, and you haven't allowed a touchdown now as far as an offensive touchdown in about three, four straight games or something like that. So, I mean, you've got to be really happy going into the playoffs with where you guys are at on defense.
Yes, I'm really proud of our defense and what we've been able to accomplish. I think we're getting better. And, I think that kickoff return kind of soured it for us because we've been used to having goose eggs up there on the scoreboard the last couple of weeks. But I think they're playing good defense, and we're going to have to play better and down the road in the playoffs because we'll be seeing a lot better football teams.
Coach Allen, as I understand it, several of your guys were a little bit sick during the week or had to miss some practices, but it seems like just about everybody was back Friday night. Tell us sort of what y'all went through this week preparing for J.J. Pierce.
Well, we had some guys out. I mean, I got sick on Wednesday, and I know exactly how they feel. It just takes about 3 days to get where you feel halfway decent. And so it was going around on the football team. And
well, we are now ready for the procession of seniors organized by groups.
I don't think you're going to be able to hear me after that.
Coach Allen, congratulations on a 10-0 season. And that concludes our coach interview, but I've got some players coming up after the commercial.
All right. Thank you very much, Jay. Our Burger House post-game show rolls on in just a moment. Again, our final score. The Scots win it tonight, 49-10, knocking off J.J. Pierce. We'll be back with our player interviews and our players of the game right after this.
The official burger of Highland Park football.
Burger House keeps my O-line fueled for the big games.
I got your back.
Mouth-watering burgers, famous fries, handmade shakes and malts made the old-fashioned way, like they were back in 1951, when we first opened our doors. Next time you have the urge for a double-double and Jack's famous fries, stop in and step back in time to our neighborhood restaurant. We would love to see you. Go Scots!
Back on our post-game show brought to you by Burger House, the official burger of Highland Park football, and I believe Jay Ellis has got our players of the game down there.
It's interesting the four guys he's got.
Yeah, so I've got the offensive players of the game brought to you by Tolleson Wealth Management. Proud supporter of the Highland Park Scots. Tonight we had all four starters catch a touchdown. One caught a couple of them, so we couldn't decide which ones. We figured all. And I'm going to let each of them describe someone else's touchdown. Lily, you pick whose touchdown and tell us how it happened.
Oh, I saw Herring. I had a great view on Herring's, and it was all goes, and he just burnt that guy and cooked him. And Brennan threw it a little bit into the wind, so the ball dipped a little bit. So Herring had to come inside and get it, and he caught it down here because the ball dived down, and then he just burned him. Just track speed, baby.
Track speed, baby. Great. I've got Jackson Heiss now. Jackson, tell us about tell us about Lily's touchdown.
On Bo's first touchdown, it was all goes too, but Shrank had a bender, so Shrank took down the safety, and Bo was left one-on-one with like a flat-footed safety, and he outran him, so it was wide open.
Good stuff. Who's next? Who wants to talk? You had one specific one you wanted to talk about, right?
Yeah.
All right, here, take that microphone and tell us what happened.
Yeah, all the receivers scored, and Jackson was sitting over there, and we got him a good play call, and Brennan threw up the ball, and he bobbled it a little bit, but the best catch I saw all night, and he ran it into the end zone. It was a great play by Jackson.
And Grayson, you caught several balls across the middle, but the one that got you in the end zone was a little speed out over here in first half. Tell us how that one happened.
Well, we had a concept where we knew they were running man, so I mean, I was able to man cut the guy over the top of me. And I tried to delay it a little bit, knowing that the corner would try to sit in the flat. So I was able to use my speed and just get to the outside, and Brennan placed a great ball, and I was able to get in the end zone. So.
Hey, the last question is for all four of you guys. Coach Allen said you all get to celebrate tonight, and then you get ready for the playoffs. How do the receivers celebrate after a 10-0 season? Anyone can answer who wants. Come on, guys.
We want a Whataburger.
Yeah!
Well, go hit it, guys. Congratulations. Those are our offensive players of the game tonight.
They sound like they're ready to go.
And if you've ever been to Whataburger, if you've ever been to Whataburger on Greenville, you probably have seen the Highland Park Scots in their postgame celebration.
All right. I believe Jay's got somebody else down there.
Nathan Harper with me. Nathan is our special teams player of the game, brought to you by Mark Clifton Homes, trusted builder of exceptional homes. Nathan Harper, on that kickoff coverage team, we saw you several times tonight, including a great tackle down on the far end. Tell us about how you all get motivated to run the field and pursue kickoffs like you do.
Well, as the coaches always say, kickoffs the first play of the defense, and it's a really important play for our team for field position and other purposes. And tonight we made a big mistake on kickoff. They ran it back for a touchdown, so we had a little bit of extra motivation to go out and make some plays the next couple times. So that's really where that came from.
Hey, Nathan, something that maybe not all the fans see all the time, but the most enthusiastic squad on the field, from my perspective, is the kickoff coverage team, because even in the ones that get kicked out of the end zone, you guys are racing down there, and you're all excited coming off. Tell us about how much energy you all have.
Well, I mean, that's really a successful play when you think about when you kick the ball out of the back of the end zone. That's honestly almost the best case scenario for the kickoff team. It means everyone did their job. The kicker did their job. Everyone did a good job getting down the field. And so it gives us a lot of energy because we call it a party in the end zone. Yeah.
Party in the end zone. Hey, they're up top. They're asking me to ask you about the beard. How long did it take you to grow that beard?
So I think it's somewhere about three weeks to a month, somewhere in that range.
Good stuff. Yeah, they're laughing up there. Good stuff. Hey, the last question. Highland Park football, I know it's a really important thing for you and your family. I know your dad was a quarterback at Highland Park, Dr. David Harper. Tell us about how special it is for you to be playing on the team that he played on, and how much you enjoy visiting with him about these games and practice during the week.
Well, it's really special for me, and to be a part of something like this tradition, this culture that we have at Highland Park, it's really huge. And to know that my dad was a part of the same team, and that I could follow in his footsteps and try to be a contributor on this team is really special.
And Nathan Harper, you've been great all year long. We're glad you're healthy. We look forward to seeing you in the playoffs next week, and you're our special teams player of the game.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nathan Harper.
All right, Nathan Harper right there. And Jay, go ahead. I'm afraid I don't want the bus to leave. I just saw one bus taking off out there, so you're going to have to give these guys a ride.
Which do we have queued up now?
Right. Defense.
Okay, they're telling me to go quick. I've got Bond here first. Tell us about that interception. This is Preston Bond.
I mean, the ball was in the air for a long time. I spotted it. I just had to go get it.
And a lot of yards run after that, too. Tell us about the blocking that these guys had for you once you told them you had picked off the ball.
I mean, it was great. Just seeing all of them go straight for the other guys, just trying to make that play. And on that last part, if I would have just hit Y button.
Hey, so how do you alert the guys that you've just picked it off? What do you yell?
I'm just screaming. No words. I'm just yelling. I don't know.
I love it. Hey, that was fantastic. You're one of our defensive players of the game. The other is Alex Prowse. Alex, we saw you on at defensive end and also at outside linebacker today. Sure. Tell us about the pressure you were putting on Pierce around the outside.
You know, it's
you just got to be ruthless on the line. I mean, that's all you got to do. The quarterback is mine. I want the quarterback. I mean, like, you want a sack? I don't know how to say this, but, like, everyone wants a sack. I mean, that's true. So it's like pressure and then build up to that sack. So
absolutely. It was fantastic. So I know last year you were playing defensive end. This year it's been mostly outside linebacker. But, sure. Again, we saw you on the defensive line some in the fourth quarter as well. Is it difficult to play both positions or the concepts the same?
I mean, it's not super difficult. I would say outside linebacker is definitely more – it's a little bit more difficult for sure. But D-line is just way more – like, I feel like it's more physical being on D-line. So, I mean, at the same time, I feel like I can handle both for sure. I mean –
Alex Prowse is the best linebacker in the nation.
Thank you, Petty.
Russell, Coach Castle, how y'all doing?
It seems like Lawson Petty's a little bit familiar with this broadcast team. Last question. Tell us about your bond with that guy over there. You must be good friends.
Petty is almost like a brother to me all the time. This kid, I'm not kidding you, this kid literally calls me after school. It's like, yo, where you at? I'm like, I'm at Jimmy John's. And he's like, I'm at your house with your brother right now. I'm like, how are you at my house? He's just like, I'm telling you, he's part of the family by now. I mean, like, he's always there 24/7, and we love it.
Hey, Alex, I'm glad we got you on camera. You're a great interview. You're a great football player. Preston, same thing. Congratulations. These are our two defensive players of the game, and that's going to do it for our player interviews here at J.J. Pierce.
Make sure you get Petty in the picture.
Exactly. Hey, I'll tell you what, our Burger House post-game show is going to roll on. We've got our play of the game coming up, our game summary stats report coming up in just a moment as well. Again, the final score, you see it right there. 49-10, Highland Park knocks off J.J. Pierce for the 11th straight time in this series. The Scots have come out on top. We'll be back in just a second.
Football. Burger House keeps my O-line fueled for the big games.
I got sure back.
Mouth-watering burgers, famous fries, handmade shakes and malts made the old-fashioned way, like they were back in 1951, when we first opened our doors. Next time you have the urge for a double-double and Jack's Famous Fries, stop in and step back in time to our neighborhood restaurant. We would love to see you. Go Scots!
Back on our Burger House post-game show, time to take a look at some of our game stats and our game summary stats brought to you by Park City's YMCA. Mike McAbee, our statistician, joins us to go over some of the numbers.
You know, it's when you go into a game like this, you're thinking just be tuned up, get ready for the playoffs. The Scots were just on all cylinders tonight as far as stats. Biggest offensive output of the season. Some really outstanding numbers. Let's see if we go to the graphic here. But the All right. So the individual numbers, I'm going to start off with the receivers. There were 10 different receivers caught passes tonight from the two quarterbacks.
Wow.
And we had, for the first time this year, two receivers over 100 yards in the same game. Mm-hmm. We've only had two receivers go over 100 yards this season at all, and then to finish up with two. Bo Lilly with 127 yards on five catches, two of those for touchdowns, and also Luke Herring had 113 yards on two catches. Basically, what an 80-yard touchdown catch will do for you.
Helps your stats, doesn't it?
And then also, as you heard during the interviews, Grayson Schrank also had a touchdown, three catches for 35 yards. And let's see, where's Jackson Heiss had three catches for 68 and also a touchdown. Another touchdown also by Colin Hale. He had two catches for 26. Marshall Miller, his first catch of the season for 10 yards. Colin Sewell had a catch for 13. Frank Musu for 10. Wilson Axley for 24. Nice play early in the game. And Colin Patrick had one catch for 6. I believe that was also his first catch of the season.
Yep.
So the two quarterbacks together, how about these numbers? First of all, for Walter Peck, just, you know, there in the fourth quarter when you're primarily running the ball, four completions out of seven attempts for 44 yards and just a short. I said Peck. And then Brennan Storer, by far his best passing night of the season, six touchdowns on 16 completions out of 23 yards, 388 yards, longest 80 yards.
Which, considering the wind he was thrown into, it makes it even more impressive.
Exactly. And his most impressive quarter is probably that second quarter when he was going into the wind.
Right.
On the ground, the Scots tonight, leading rusher was Wilson Axley, five carries for 39 yards. Storer had six carries for 52 yards and a touchdown that he literally just walked into the end zone.
Exactly.
Peck had the one sack that was recorded against the Scots tonight. Frank Musa had four carries for 10 yards. Wagner Perry, three for five. And Brian Rapp had two carries for 23 yards. Really, just everybody touching the ball tonight had something really positive happen there. For the team numbers overall for the Scots tonight, 554 yards of total offense on 53 offensive plays. That's an average of 10.5 yards per snap. For the Mustangs, 62 offensive plays for 194 yards. The defense held them to just 3.1 yards per play. Pierce had 12 first downs. Highland Park was one of their season best on first downs with 23. Third down conversions. The Scots were 4 out of 7, and Pierce was 5 out of 16. Awesome regular season there.
It was a great regular season, and we got the playoffs next Friday night.
The formalities are over with. It's time to get down to business. I think everybody in Highland Park, right or wrong, they love the regular season, but they wait all year for the playoffs because this, especially going into 6A, because the thought was, oh, Highland Park can't compete in 6A. Well, they proved they can in the regular season. Now the next challenge, prove you can in the playoffs.
Friday night, it'll be Arlington Bowie who comes to Highlander Stadium.
I don't want it to get overlooked. A 10-0 season is special. To go 8-0 in district?
Yep.
That's hard.
Yep.
That doesn't happen very often.
It doesn't happen.
Yep.
Well, and then you just add to that, the two non-district games, Flower Mound Marcus and Louisville. Louisville won their district, and I believe ours was the only loss they had. I think, if I'm not mistaken,
yep,
Louisville was 9-1.
Yep.
And so we found a way to win that game on top of that 8-0 district record.
Well, tell you what, thanks to Pat, thanks to Jay, thanks to Owen Marie for his help, thanks to Mike, thanks to Jim, thanks to Yvonne Zuniga, who's back up there, and I'm Russell. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll be back next Friday night. We're going to leave you with highlights. Our plays of the game are brought to you by Riddell Plumbing, home of honesty, quality, great customer service, and proud supporter of the Highland Park Scots. There you see the final score, 49-10, Scots over J.J. Pierce tonight. So long, have a great weekend, and we'll see you next Friday night. Good night.